TheBoxingVoice.com is brought to you by El Camino Electrical Services. El Camino Electric has over 15 years of commercial experience with startup companies, work consisting of design build, clean room fabrications, lithography labs, test labs, special tools, and equipment installs. El Camino Electrical specializes in the install of EVC from the start of the project to the finish. El Camino Electrical Services is an established commercial electrical contractor with the ability and experience to carry out industrial and commercial work. Services include design build, electric vehicle supply equipment infrastructure, semiconductor fabrication clean rooms, special equipment and tools, startup companies, turnkey installation, electrical vehicle supply equipment infrastructure. So head over to ElCaminoElectricalServices.com for all your electrical needs.
Have you ever wanted to hear the host discuss a subject that wasn't on the agenda? Or worse, have you been denied the chance to introduce a topic because of the time restrictions of the show? Do you have an idea for a show? Something that is not being covered or talked about in today's boxing media, but is important to you? Would you like the opportunity to control the Boxing Voice conversation and have TBV's entertaining panel discuss your topic with their brand of diverse opinions and entertaining banter? Now, The Boxing Voice is giving you, the listener, the power, total control. With our new on-demand service, you can contribute to the conversation in a way that isn't being offered anywhere else. Finally, you can get the exact show you want with all the same unpredictability you've come to expect from our live radio show podcast. Simply fill out the form below, decide from our many options, and give us your concept. That's not all. TBV On Demand is giving you full control by allowing you to choose the date and time. Plus, for the first time in radio history, we will be giving you the opportunity to become part of the show by deciding how involved you want to be.
BoxingVoice.com.
What broke him down? Was it just
body punching? I was hitting with body punching. I heard him. Actually, he was crying in there.
You're saying that Big was crying when you hit him?
Yes.
When did that happen? And perhaps the fourth round on.
BoxingVoice.com.
So that you knew you had him by that time.
Absolutely, I knew you were fucking cuffing and taking those punches.
Deep enough reproduction.
Making women's gestures like, oh, oh, oh.
Let's go, champ. This is a champ. It's your enemy, champ. This is with the big champ. This is with Sally, my nigga. Go.
BoxingVoice.com.
I'm a team like he's a C-plus fighter. I'm going to dominate. I'm going to go off his fight.
I'm talking about punching. We're going to punch you for 12 rounds. Either the referee says you had enough, or you just say you had enough. You just stay your ass there all night until you ain't had enough.
I feel I'm the best in the sport, and to be the best, you got to beat the best. And all I did was beat opponents. I worked my way from the bottom to the top. I won a title by beating top competition and top fighters. This guy was
hard to
fight.
He was a
paper champion.
Do you feel that you're the best super middleweight right now?
Let's go, champ.
He can bring the pressure. He can box. I'm a true champion. I'm willing to go to his turf in Atlantic City. I'm a step on him. I'm a crush him. Y'all can mark my words. I'm a crush him. He's a C-plus fighter. I'm an A-plus fighter. Come Saturday night next week. All the fans tune in because I'm going to dominate. This guy is flat for these swing bouts. I'm not worried about who his trainer is because his trainer can't get in there and fight for him.
BoxingVoice.com. BoxingVoice.com.
Salute to the God, DiBiase, Dollar DiBiase Productions with the intro. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We are here. Unfortunately, we're not simulcasting from YouTube, but we're going to get into that. We're going to talk a little bit of boxing. We're going to make that announcement that everyone,
Geico presents sharing versus oversharing. Way early this morning, Brad Higdon shared a major spoiler alert from everyone's favorite hit show, sad emojis to express his feelings about the plot twist, and a playlist he made to drown out his sorrows? Dude, oversharing alert. Brad, Geico has something worth sharing with those who haven't befriended you. Like how you could save hundreds on your car insurance at geico.com. So stop moping about the post-apocalyptic world and start saving in the real world. Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
Is waiting for, right? And we're going to talk a little bit of Andrew Tabidi and Keith Tapia. These guys not only made it to headline status, but they're headlining TBV's episode info, along with Canelo Alvarez in those Amir Khan pay-per-view numbers. Did they flop or not? I mean, we got guys like Rick Glacier out there definitely saying that they did. So we're going to get into that. We're going to get into the news and notes. And obviously, we're going to get to the streets because we are the voice of the people. So remember, that number is 646-478-3068 is the number to call in if you want to get it off your chest, want to make your picks for tomorrow night's fight. Dusty Harrison, he's going to be in action this week, taking on his biggest opponent till date, you know, in Mike Dallas. So there's definitely a lot to talk about. Glove giveaways. You know, we're always giving away a glove over here on the Boxing Voice. And by now, our two winners should have gotten those gloves and all our shirts. We are thankful that you guys have sent us those pictures wearing the shirts that we sent you. So, you know, salute to all you guys. Continue supporting the show and continue getting yourself some little TBV swag like that. Speaking of gloves, what do we got? What do we got to give right about now? What could we give? Who's fighting? I got to go through the box, see what we got for you guys. Once I get one of these co-hosts to jump on here with me and, you know, give me a little bit of free time, maybe we can do that and see what we're giving away. So I want to just remind everyone that those iTunes reviews are the most important thing.
Remember to rate us 5 stars on iTunes.
You already know. You have to. That is the most important. If you want to help TBV, you want to help us grow, what you have to do is definitely review the show, thumbs up the videos on YouTube, you know, and definitely continue to share. Continue to share, man. You know, we have to invest in us because no one else is going to do it, right? Speaking of investing in us, you know, Blue Steel Academy, Boxing Academy, my boys out there in Akron, Ohio, you know, they're always putting together some great shows. Always thinking of the amateurs, and this time no different. Champions Are Forever is the title of this amateur boxing show. It's going to be held tomorrow night, May 13th at 7 p.m. at Lock 3, downtown Akron, 200 South Main Street, Akron, Ohio. And that's 44308 is the zip code if you want to GPS that. And check out some amateurs, man. Listen, Blue Steel, you know, you can check out Northeast Ohio Boxing YouTube to check out most of those fighters and see just how far they've gone, man. Remember Cordell Powell, he's from there, and a few others, you know. Hey, Keith Tapia, Bobby, he comes from Akron. So remember, man, those guys put out some pretty good amateurs. And speaking of Akron, you know, Sean Porter, Ken Porter, Akron, Ohio area, Cleveland. You know, we were with them yesterday in New York City. Well, actually all week, you know, it's been a Sean Porter, Ken Porter takeover. The festivities were great all week. You know, there's going to be, he's going to be closing it out tomorrow, heading out to a university and doing some things before a 4 o'clock flight. But, yesterday was, the best. It was some, celebrity sparring and, Sean got in the ring with Charlamagne Tha God, from Power 105. Over here in the tri-state area, New York City, the Breakfast Club, very popular radio personality. You know, obviously someone I look up to, is definitely a show that I used to listen to every morning faithfully until I got massively busy. But yeah, man, he got in there and, look, he held his own. He did good, but the truth is the truth. You know, there was a lot of sparring. Also, my boy Barack Best got in the ring from, Cyrus. You guys remember him. He is the co-host of the I Can Hit Show that, you know, those two guys came on the other day or, you know, a couple months ago, Ak and Barack. So Barack got in the ring with Sean Porter. And you know, I've seen the comments. Guys are like, oh, you know, Sean is taking Keith lightly. He's out here doing the celebrity stuff, you know. And I don't know, man. We're 2 months out from the fight. And all that I can see in this week of hanging with them is that they are ready. You know, they are ready both mentally, physically, and spiritually. So I really don't think that anything can harm them unless he gets cut in sparring, right? And being in the ring with myself, because I did jump in the ring with him, and if you haven't checked that out, I put the video on YouTube because I'm not ashamed. I'm not ashamed. And listen, how many – look, I can die a happy man, all right? So for all the haters out there, okay, all the people that are going to waste their time and energy typing something negative, listen, I can die a happy man today. My first time ever, ever sparring in my life was with Showtime Sean Porter. So, know what I'm saying? You can write whatever you want. I did good. Yo, I landed a straight right on my boy Sean. Like, please, man. It was wonderful, wonderful. So definitely check out the video. Share it. Tell a friend to tell a friend. And, you know, the announcement that we were going to make is this one, right? Usually we're simulcasting live here. But our live streaming privileges have been revoked due to the video that we did Saturday night at 12:30, technically Sunday morning, for the Canelo Alvarez immediate KO reaction, right? So, you know, obviously you guys seen the video. It was at like 500,000 views and, you know, a bunch of likes and dislikes, and it was taken down for copyright infringement. Now, your guess is as good as mine. What and how did we infringe when it's just us, like it's always us talking boxing? But it did, you know. So that's the way the cookie crumbles. They took away the video streaming privileges until we can dispute it, and we're doing that. So I did have about 3 to 5 faithful listeners of the Boxing Voice who are also attorneys. You know who you are. Hit me up because we're going to fight this one. I mean, the first time that TBV basically has a video that goes viral, we're being robbed and stripped of our hard work. And, you know, guys that were on that call that stood up late, they deserve to be heard by the 500,000 people and or more that would have heard it, right? Or continue to listen to it, because obviously we all know that that one video, it did wonders for us in terms of growth, and you see that in the live numbers for the next show, right? So it was damaging. So once we find out all the, I guess, legalities, right, and we're probably gonna have to put in a petition, right, and have the TBV on me. Get at these people because, come on, they can't strip of us of our hard work. That being said, that's why we're not live. So we won't be live until that is resolved in terms of video. But, you know, for you guys who jump on a treadmill, listen to this the next day, I just wasted 5 minutes of your life, right? It is what it is. Let's talk some boxing here. We have to talk about, I guess, the Canelo Alvarez and Amir Khan pay-per-view numbers. There's been a lot of speculation, a lot of rumors here. You know, I was hoping that this guy did over 1 million, if not 1 million. I'm going to hold off on my judgment. I'm just going to read the facts. LA Times, not even the facts, excuse me. I'm going to read the headline from the LA Times because, again, I'm waiting for hopefully HBO, but I'm hearing HBO has already said that they're not going to release pay-per-view numbers. It sounds like that time Showtime said the same thing when Mayweather-Guerrero wasn't said to do that good, right? So it seems like we're going around the same ring around the rosy with these numbers. Whenever they're not as good as companies or promoters expect, they kind of withhold the numbers on us. But again, I don't care. The event was great. The knockout was great. Amir Khan's okay. You know, this stuff is for the guys that, you know, live to be mad. I don't really care how many numbers. All I wanted to do was big numbers so that boxing can grow. That being said, the LA Times is reporting that Canelo Alvarez versus Amir Khan, that bout generated close to 600 pay-per-view buys. So you can see off of that number alone that there's just a lot of negative people because this news somehow is bad news when, you know, Mayweather did 500 with Berto. So if Canelo's doing, you know, 600 with Amir Khan, I think that's fucking pretty good. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, we got these guys that wake up with dark clouds, but not over here on the Boxing Voice. Hell no. We're smiling. We're happy, man. We are blessed. And we're thanking Jesus for all our blessings. You know what I'm saying? Alvarez's numbers against Khan indicate that the fight fans are flocking to the WBC middleweight champion, right? Or 155-pound middleweight champion. I mean, we have to be because, again, you know, Pacquiao, who just had 400 buys before announcing that he was going to retire. So he only did 400 with Bradley. So, again, by reaching 600,000 buys at 25, Alvarez is definitely staking his claim as a pay-per-view star. And I'm just going to open it up and see what the phone lines think. We're going to head on out to 323. No producer just yet because this is something new, obviously, but talk to us and let us know where you're calling from.
Fern Gully from Los Angeles.
Fern Gully, what's up?
Oh, not much, man. Man, just heard about that YouTube privilege. That episode you guys did after the Canelo knockout was hot, man. I was on it. I was on cue. I was on hold for 10 minutes, and I realized, what am I doing? I'm pretty wasted, and I don't want to sound a fool, but that knockout, I called it since the fight was announced, I think, on my second call ever to the Boxing Voice. Fourth round, it was a six-round KO. So that was it was always good. It was bound to happen. Triple G has arrived. I'm getting casual fans that only hear about Triple G or the big dogs like the Mayweathers, the Canelos. Now Triple G is under it. I get people in the office asking me, so is Triple G going to be Canelo's next opponent? And finally, I'm calling in for some crow for the Herrera fight. Thank you. I was surprised on that loss. And lastly, I'm pretty sure that you saw the Porter versus Gibbs. I got to take crow for that one. I had you inside three. That's my call.
Hey, listen, I'm not even going to take any credit because I made it to the third, but I don't think I made it out, according to them. Or I guess it was – no, it was only two rounds, so you still won.
Perfect.
Cool. I think it was two rounds. I'm not sure, man. That left to the body hurt too much.
I could tell, man. I could tell. But you hung in there, man. You're popping your jab as much as you could. So that's all we can ask.
Now, listen, TV. The bottom line was I didn't want to hurt the man, and then every boxing fan hate me for not giving them Keith Thurman versus Porter. I could have easily went Klitschko style and just laid on him, you know? but Ken was like, look, we're just here to have fun. And I'm like, no worries, yeah. Brother. Yo, I landed that right, and then Sean did that footwork. I mean, damn, I don't know how Thurman's going to deal with that. It felt like he was in there playing football, and I'm like, oh, man. Then he started beating me to the body. No. I don't like it.
Oh, I've seen it, man. Yep. He had you spinning around. Good stuff, man. I appreciated the video, man. No one else is doing it like this, like the Boxing Voice. Bomb Squad!
Thank you, Fern Gully, man. Thanks for calling in, brother. We're going to get to some other callers in just,
yes, sir.
In just a bit here. I actually want to look for our good friend, Fernando Pimentel, our Los Angeles correspondent. Fernando, you there? Hello? Nope, guess not. Let me see. Maybe this is it. Fern. Hello? And that is not. Dropping the ball over here. All right. Well, in the meantime, right, we'll move on and get to somebody else. But I did want to talk to Fernando because he is out there in Los Angeles. And he was at the Abner Juarez Jesus Cuellar press conference today, which was the undercard for the Sean Porter Keith Thurman. Fern, tell us about the festivities, brother.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, all right, man. So I was at the Juarez Cuellar press conference today. Basically, it was showing off of the two fighters. Steven Espinoza was there. It was a nice little atmosphere, a lot more packed than I expected it to be. I didn't think a lot of people would show up considering it's just the co-main event, but then it was held here in Los Angeles. Abner is big here in L.A. His trainer, Robert Garcia, is pretty much big anywhere. So I you know, we didn't expect that many people to show up. But, hey, a lot of people did. It was nice, very respectful. They both respect each other. They both gave each other enough credit. But you could tell that they're both ready for war. Can you hear me?
How are Abner and Robert meshing, in your opinion?
Robert and Abner are meshing very well. Thankfully, I honestly think the cancellation of the original fight between Abner and Montiel was a blessing because it basically gave them more time to get acquainted with one another. Abner, in the interview that we did with him earlier today that'll be being sent to Ness, he straight up said that, you know, originally when I first got there, it was kind of cold. You know, I didn't know much about the camp. I wasn't able to, like, be comfortable. And what I mean by that is bring friends or bring family around at the camp. But now, you know, since the cancellation, me coming back to this one, to this camp again, everything seems well. Everything seems to be meshing. We're working well. I like the fact. I even asked him, like, you know, Robert Garcia used to be Cuellar's trainer. Do you think that, you know, having him in your corner, also the advantages you have of experience, give you guys the upper hand in this bout? I won't give you the answer. You could obviously know what he said, but check out the interview on the YouTube channel. But they're meshing very well.
That's definitely good to hear, man. I want to see Abner bounce back. You know, Abner is a guy that, you know, because us fight fans, and I say us because I'm included, because we're so fickle, you know, we look at a guy like Abner and you know, some of us might say he's washed up or he's done or he's seen better days. But the case is still that he's been in there with everybody. And now getting in there with Jesus Cuellar, you know, another champion, not, you know, a gimme fight at all. You know, he fought Leo Santa Cruz. He fought man, he fought Moreno, man. You got to be a hardcore. He fought Anselmo Moreno. I mean, he fought Johnny Gonzalez, right? He fought, man, what was that kid's name? What was the, wasn't he like, man, the first one that he got the draw
to? Are you talking Ibeko?
No. Ibeko's the, like, you know, no, not Ibeko. The one way before that, when he was first on Showtime before the Super Six or whatever that little thing was for those little guys, not Darchinian. Way before that. The first guy, he had, like, yellow shorts on.
I'm trying to remember, too. That name does escape me.
I'm going to have to go to BoxRec, see? Whatever.
I don't have BoxRec to go to.
Man, it's looking like your guy out there, Dominic Brazil, or Brazili. How, what's the pronunciation out there for this guy?
Brazil. Okay. Dominic, yep. Brazil. Okay.
Well, it's looking like he might be an overnight celeb with this fight, man. What's your thoughts?
Hey, my thoughts on this is anybody who's going up for a championship fight, especially in the heavyweight division, especially at this moment in time, considering the boom that's going on in the heavyweight division, they are going to become an overnight celebrity. They are going to reap the benefits of such. Dominic Brazil out here, I don't know what's going on with him because, as you know, we're trying to get into in communications with him, to speak with him, to go look at him, go see how his camp is going. I know the fight's like a month away or so, but we want to see what he's got. We want to see what he's going to bring to the table. You know, we all heard what everybody thinks about him when he fought Mansoor and everything. You know, that they think he's out of shape and he's just a big guy. So obviously, I know he hears things like that. So we want to see him. We want to see what's going on. Given the overnight cred, man, I say however you get it, especially in the sport of boxing. Like you said in the last segment when it came to Abner, once you lose a fight, fans become fickle. So get yours while you can. And if this is his chance to get his and become a celebrity, let him do it. And I know you've seen the interviews. The guy's articulate. The guy's very well educated. The guy, let's say he does become quote-unquote an overnight celebrity, loses to Joshua, doesn't box again. The guy has a career as an analyst. He's really good and well-spoken for.
Now, man, listen, I agree. The reason I bring it up is because, you know, it's like bittersweet for me. You know, The Rock, who Dwayne Johnson, who I am a fan of not only from wrestling – and bodybuilding and acting and Ballers on HBO, just all around fan of Dwayne Johnson. Now me, an even bigger fan, because he retweeted Boxing Guru's Instagram about the face-off that was held outside of, you know, all the cameras and such. So definitely check out The Rock's Instagram and what he did. You know, and when he retweeted it, it got instantly over a million views, right? And it was hilarious to see all the comments from casuals, and also, you know, insanely good for boxing that, you know, a list celebrity like that took to boxing, said, and again, you have to look at his caption, because it's not just the fact that he retweeted the Sky Sports face-off. It's beyond that. It's the caption and the engagement that his fans received or partaked in his comment section. And again, that's only a bonus for boxing. And when A-listers like that are bringing it to light, it's obviously good for Brazil, promotion for the fight, good for Anthony Joshua, and build-up, right?
It's good for the sport in general. What have we always talked about? That the golden age of boxing is the heavyweight division. That's the golden division right there. And right now that it's having the inflow with Deontay Wilder and Povetkin happening in 2 weeks, Anthony Joshua being as exciting as he is, contenders like Brazil, we have Klitschko and Fury. It's great. It's a great time, especially if someone like The Rock, who I've been a fan of since he appeared on the scene in wrestling and even, like you said, beyond that, acting and everything. It's like it's great for them, for us, for our sport, for that to happen, to get that knowledge and to get that out there to the masses. Cause, come on, wrestling fans, I don't know. I'm a wrestling fan, but I like boxing as well. I don't know how many of them are. Those many eyes, again, you said it got retweeted and for over a million times. That's amazing right there. When does a tweet about boxing get retweeted over a million times if it isn't Floyd talking smack about somebody? So it's bringing attention to the sport. It's bringing attention to the sport, and that is what is awesome. That is what this sport needs, especially at the era of Mayweather and Pacquiao being over. We hear them coming back maybe for one more fight, but still, we need something else other than them to hold down boxing. And if
we have something else now, and I know you didn't get an opportunity. Obviously, you were settling in, but we were talking a little bit about the fact that Canelo Alvarez rumored pay-per-view numbers by the LA Times are to be 600,000. And we got those naysayers. We got those same guys that I'm talking about, those same guys that wake up to be mad with black clouds over their head. They're upset, saying that these numbers somehow are bad. But this is a 25-year-old kid. And last time I checked, this is better than Berto Floyd.
Let's take it back to the last fight of the century, which was Oscar De La Hoya versus Felix Trinidad. That fight alone was one of the most anticipated fights of all time. Pay-per-view wise, 1.25 million buys. Four of the 2.5 million that we got for Mayweather, Pacquiao, Mayweather, Canelo, every single time out. It depends on opposition as well. We all knew, you know, Khan was mismatched given the weight and everything, even though Khan was doing great in the fight. But everybody knew what the outcome would be if Canelo would be able to catch him. So let's say me and my friends, we were talking earlier today while we were heading to the press conference and back. We were talking about now, do they make Canelo versus Triple G? And what would be a good estimated pay-per-view number for that fight? My guess is 1.2 to 1.5. A lot of people will probably look at that and frown upon it, thinking like, oh, but it's not Canelo Mayweather. Of course it's not.
But wait a minute. Because
if
Lemieux Golovkin only did anywhere from 97 to 150, right? How does Golovkin Canelo do 1.5 when Khan, I want to say Khan is more popular than Triple G. He's definitely more known.
I will debate you on that, and we both know we're on the same side when I believe that Khan is more known.
I'll debate you this way. Fernando, I'll just say this, because what's going to happen is people are going to bring up ticket sales as a form to say Triple G is more popular, so I'll just gracefully
I'm going to bring it up
as a talking argument, and I'll just gracefully bow out and say Triple G is more popular than Khan, because both of them are not from America, and both of them have been fighting on U.S. television and only one of them really has a ticket market. Khan doesn't sell the amount of tickets that Triple G sells anywhere, so I answered my own question. Sorry.
All right, no, that's cool, it's cool. Well, speaking of, since you were talking originally, the point of Khan, Canelo, and everything, thankfully, I'm, you know, since we know boxing a lot, Luis Garcia was at the Marez Cuellar press conference. Luis Garcia is the strength and conditioning coach for Abner Marez, but he is also the strength and conditioning coach and a cornerman for Amir Khan. So got to speak to him about, you know, a little bit about him with the about what happened in the fight, about Khan's preparation for it, how the fight was going in his eyes, and basically the knockout. He, like everybody else, is somewhat disgusted by the scoring of that fight. There is no way that at any point in time anybody could have Canelo up throughout that fight at the point when it ended. And he was somewhat disgusted about it. He talked about how Amir's reaction to it was like, you know what, I'm kind of glad I got caught with that punch. Imagine if I had gone 12 rounds and they were going to screw me over in the scorecard. That would have been even worse for me and boxing.
Yeah, I mean, it was looking that way. And, you know, it's something that we said the show before, like, hey, if he wins, does he even win? You know, I asked fighters, promoters, I asked people, does he even get the win? Because we've seen Canelo Alvarez get a draw scorecard against Mayweather, for God's sakes, when no one had him winning a round. So, I don't know. Fern, stay with me here. We're going to open up these streets.
Okay.
And continue to drive this car. Let's see who's out here with us. We won't get our names and numbers till 8 o'clock when the producer checks in. So in the meantime, when we go to these phone calls, baby, it's roll call. And you know what that means. It's who's this, where you're calling from, and, you know, check in, right? So if you're first-time caller, say, Ness, first-time caller, we play that intro because it's tradition around these parts. And if you got some crow to eat, you know what to do. 623, talk to me.
Alden from Arizona, Ness. First of all, I saw those videos of you boxing Sean Porter. Man, you look like a big-ass Eris Landy Lara in there. Throwing one punch at a time. You had good movement. I got to give it to you. You had a good movement. But you should have Klitschko'd his ass with just a 1-2, 1-2. Or maybe you could have gave him like a – but you're too tall. Maybe you could have given him like a pull counter and then gave him an uppercut caught at that. But I think Kenny would have jumped in if you would have done that. So, but you had a good effort. I got to give it to you, Ness. But with the numbers thing, with the Canelo Khan, I think look at Canelo and Cotto. They did 900,000, right? And you had two Hispanic fighters on there. So the thing is with Triple G, I think it'll get some of that 1 million, maybe. But I don't think it's going to do no 1.2, 1.8. I just don't think it'll get up to that high. But it could. But it could hit a million, 1.1. And then, again, that fight was a circus fight, man. Like, he fought a guy two divisions up. So, what do you expect? What do you expect to happen? But, and I think for the fights, I think Tabidi is going to win. He's fighting out of Mayweather's camp. He's doing pretty good. He can crack pretty good. So, I got him winning. But that's pretty much I got, Ness. But keep up the great work. Those are the best videos, man.
Thank you, brother. Thank you. Appreciate it, man. Continue to share that. And we're going to continue to grow. It's funny that he said he's picking Tabidi. That's the one I want to know. I want to know everyone's thoughts on that fight. That one made it to our headline and a headline. So we have to get everyone's pick. Fern, who are you picking in this Tabidi-Keith Tapia fight?
I'll be honest with you. I feel like you right now. I am very much a casual when it comes to either of these two guys. I know nothing about them. I would have to go to BoxRec, look at their record, and just compare and go from there. But just by name alone and by association, I'm going to go incredibly casual as hell, and I'm just going to pick Keith Tapia.
Now, wait a minute. You said by name alone. What do you mean by name alone? What do you know about Keith Tapia? Why is he more of a name than Andrew Tabidi, who signed to Mayweather Promotions?
No. What I mean by name alone is like, all right, you don't follow sports. You don't follow sports as much. You don't follow any other sports as much. But I'll give it to you like this, the best analogy I could tell you. Super Bowl earlier this year. I wasn't looking to bet. I wasn't looking at anything. I knew so much about the teams, this, that, and the third. I had my pick. But I asked my girl, not knowing anything about the team, the Carolina Panthers or Denver Broncos. Just by name alone, she said she went with the Denver Broncos. That's what I'm going by. Just by hearing the names, I'm just going to go with Keith Tapia. I know nothing about these guys. I'm being incredibly casual.
Listen, there's nothing wrong with that. Together we learn. These are guys that were introduced to us by PBC. I'm holding my ace in the hole for the end of the show because I know a lot about both guys. And if you, not you, Fern, but you, the listener, have been staying close to TBV like you should be, part of the Army, then you would have seen both of them come up on our YouTube channel because we've been following them closely. If you have been listening to this show for 4 years, well, then you've heard Machine Gun on this show and you've heard Andrew Tabidi on this show and you've seen them both on our YouTube. So do your homework because that fight's tomorrow night. Let's see, what do we got here? 847, you're live on a Boxing Voice. Who's this? Where are you calling from?
Yo, Fight Doctor in the house. I'm on Rick James status.
Fight Doctor. I got to give you an intro, man, because you're alumni status.
Don't even respect your ass. That's why it's time for the doctor to check your ass, nigga.
Yo, I just want to make a couple of quick points. First, with the pay-per-view numbers for Khan Canelo, we don't really know what the real numbers are. It's all rumors. Until HBO makes the official announcement, then we'll never know what the numbers are. Golden Boy is going to have their number. Now, Golden Boy has come out and said it's 600,000. The promoter is always the least credible source with this type of information. So Golden Boy says 600,000 pay-per-views, that's BS, okay? I'm hearing as low as 335 and somewhere in the middle of 335 and 600, 460 right now somewhere. So I think what we can assume is that on the high end, it is at most 600,000, but probably closer to 450, I'm thinking. And so people are bringing up the whole issue of the pay-per-view numbers as if, let's say it only did 400,000 pay-per-views, okay? That's still actually not a bad number given the opponent, okay? So there's no reason to hate on Canelo because at the end of the day, the only people who are selling more pay-per-views than him are Pacquiao and Mayweather, and they're both retired. So, you know, in any negotiations with Golovkin, Alvarez is still in the driver's seat at the end of the day, which, you know what, we shouldn't really even talk about that fight because realistically, it's not going to happen. I honestly don't believe HBO wants that fight to happen. I honestly don't believe I know Golden Boy doesn't want that fight to happen, and I suspect K2 doesn't want that fight to happen because at the end of the day, if you're Canelo, why fight Golovkin now when you can go and beat up more welterweights and sell almost 500,000 pay-per-views beating up welterweights who, you know, are going to be bigger names than Golovkin? Because let's be honest here, you know, listen, I know that the Golovkinites are not going to like this, but facts are facts. Golovkin is just not a draw. He's not. Okay, when you sell 98,000 pay-per-views, you are not a draw. So I think K2 and the bum Golovkin, you know, crowd, you guys need to get that through your thick skulls. Golovkin is not a draw.
Hey, Fight Doctor, let me ask you, man, because call after call, I let you call in and just take shots. Like, I don't understand. How did this call go from pay-per-view numbers to Golovkin and all the hateful terms? Like, why do you hate him?
I do not hate Golovkin. I actually respect Golovkin as a fighter, okay?
So why do you call him Golovkin?
All right, well, listen, all right. Look at his resume.
Let's just find out why. Where is this coming from?
Let's look at the man's resume. Over the last 3-4 years, who has he fought? Who has he beat?
Okay, but stop there. Let's stop
Dominique
there.
Wade?
Wait a minute. Let's stop there because you and I are both knowledgeable enough to know the names on his resume. So we don't really need to recite each one. I just want you to tell me right now, do you honestly think that the people that he's fought are bums?
Willie Monroe Jr.? I mean, come on, man. What was the guy he fought in Monaco? What was the guy's name?
I can look at you in your eyes. I'm asking you, are those men that he fought, are they bums?
No, they're not bums.
All right, then.
They're
so
tomato cans. That's what they are, okay? It's tomato can after tomato can after tomato can, okay? At some point.
Yeah, I thought for 1 second we cracked that armor of yours. No way. Traditional fight doctor right there. Damn. Oh, man.
Listen, man, it's been tomato can after tomato can. At some point, the dog and pony show has to come to an end, okay? And I'm tired of hearing the story about, oh, well, you know, nobody wants to fight him and everybody is ducking him. What I want to know is, how is it that all of these C-minus fighters have the heart and are brave enough to fight Golovkin, but the top-level guys at middleweight aren't? Okay, that just doesn't make sense to me. I'm sorry, but... Listen, he could have had the Ward fight, but no, he bitched out 164-pound catch weight. He can fight Laura, okay, but for whatever reason, he doesn't want to fight Laura. I suspect Laura goes 12 rounds and win or lose makes him look bad, so they don't want that fight. So, I mean, listen, if all you're going to do is fight tomato cans and you have to, look, you make your bed, you have to sleep in it, okay?
Okay, so you know, are you just going to call week after week? Like, are all your calls always going to be just about, like, calling Golovkin a bum?
I'm not calling Golovkin a bum. His opponents, his opposition, okay, he's done nothing but knock over tomato can. At the tomato can. Now, listen, I'm
you're
a boxing fan.
Dominic Wade, a tomato can.
Yes, I'm calling Dominic Wade a tomato can. I'm calling Willie Monroe Jr. a tomato can.
Dominic Wade had over 100 and something amateur fights. Dominic Wade has been in the ring with almost every big name you can mention, okay? What are you talking about, man?
Willie Monroe Jr. had, what, all of 6 KOs? I mean,
Willie,
come on, man.
Listen,
talk to me.
Listen,
guy has 6 knockouts.
Listen to me. Peter Quillin had 9 amateur fights, and he became a world champion. So if Willie Monroe's biggest achievement till date is winning the Boxino, you have to respect that. You can't call him a bum. He still went through a tournament of fighters and came out on top.
I didn't call Willie Monroe a bum.
So what
I call him a tomato can, okay?
And what is the difference? They both disrespectful. What's the difference?
Listen, man. The man has 6 KOs, okay?
Tell me what's the difference, please. I just want to learn with you. You older than me. Teach me.
Look, you know what? I honestly don't even know what the difference between a bum and a tomato can is. I just know a tomato can when I see one, okay? And looking down Golovkin's resume as of late, tomato can after tomato can after tomato can. Listen, at some point, the dog and pony show has to come to an end, okay?
No. You know what? At some point, your dog and pony show has to come to an end. You have to start coming up with actual facts, because when Daniel Gill is a 2-time world champion, you can't call him a bum.
Three seconds.
Have that many amateur fights and be a bum and become an eliminator. He went through an eliminator to get his shot. You know, Curtis Stevens wasn't no bum, and he just proved that by knocking out Texeria last week. So you need to stop, man.
Curtis Stevens wasn't even ranked at 160 when he fought Golovkin. What are you talking about, man? What is Curtis Stevens? What? Who?
You know why I don't
Come
care.
On, man. Just
I'm
going to
tell you why I don't
Come
care.
On, look,
I'm
stop,
why
man.
I don't
stop.
Care. I'm going to tell you why I don't care. Because I know that there's people out there that they like you for whatever reason. They love what you say. And I like you, too. I just don't understand how could you be delusional for this long.
Delusional. Let's talk about facts. Now, you want to talk about facts? All right. Daniel Gill was no 2-time champion, okay? Look, there can only be one champion in a given division at a time. No, sir. There's a difference between – No, sir. You got it all wrong. There's a difference between champion and paper titleist. Daniel Gill was a 2-time paper titleist. Okay, which is what Golovkin currently is. The champion at middleweight is Canelo Alvarez, who won his title from Miguel Cotto, who won his title from Sergio Martinez, okay? Those are the recent middleweight champions. Daniel Gill, Felix Sturm, all these other cats.
The only paper titles on the Boxing Voice, the only thing that's categorized as a paper title on the Boxing Voice is a vacant title one. And that still depends who the two fighters are. Because if it's two quality fighters going at it for a vacant title, man, I'm not going to disrespect them and say they won a paper title. Okay? So don't be saying that they are paper titles. It depends who they won it from and if it was vacant, and Gil didn't win no vacant title. I'm about to box wreck him because I know. We used to cover Gil like 3 years ago. He used to be the same way we did our show on YouTube. He used to call in from Australia.
Okay, wait. Let me ask you this question.
Ryan.
Let me ask this question. Who did Daniel Gill win his title from?
Let's look. I don't know. Let's look. Probably, I think it was maybe Sylvester, maybe. I'm not sure.
Okay. Was his name Sergio Martinez?
No.
Because if the answer to that question is no, then the title that Daniel Gill.
No. Listen to me, man. Sergio Martinez was 154-pounder when Daniel Gill was a champ. Knock it off.
Wait.
In that division twice, man. That's what you're not getting. Anyway, we're getting caught up in the weeds. I got to keep it moving, play. I always do this with you. You're toxic, man. You pulled me in like quicksand, you do. Later. Good night. 225, talk to me.
Number one, Nash, you got exposed with Sean Porter. You know, you should have fought tall. But look, let me get to my boy. My boy, who I like listening to, Fight Doctor. Let me defend Fight Doctor. Now, I'm not a GGG hater, but I understand where the man coming from. The guy haven't fought nobody. He fought Ishida, who was coming off of two losses. He fought Gabe Rosado, who was brought up from 154 to 160. Didn't even fight him at a catchweight for the first fight at 160. He fought Daniel Gill, who was an old Daniel Gill, who was one loss removed. He fought Stevenson after Stevenson was already being beat the shit out of by Daniel Parker. Come on, the dude, when the fight doctor saying that's because he's unproven. We as fans, we as boxing fans, are used to Manny Pacquiao, Floyd Mayweather, Roy George Jr., Bernard Hopkins going fighting the big fights and proving themselves out for their greatness. So when it was time for Triple G to prove himself and fight another fighter who on his level, don't get me wrong, I think Triple G is a talented fighter. 350-plus career fights, 7 years as a pro, as a champion at middleweight, and he's a great fighter. So when you get Andre Ward, who was trying to beat him at 168, who's haven't lost as an amateur since he was 12, multi-arm champion winning at 168, and wanted to meet him on the same level fight, he backed out. No, the offer. I have a video with you asking Tom Loughner, what would it take to make the war in GGG fight? Tom turned around and told you himself, Rob Nation just need to make an offer. So an offer was got made, and it didn't happen. So when people come down on GGG, it's not about he's a great fighter. He looked all spedazzled and all this great, but he's fucking unproven, dude. Stop trying to hate on that man because he's being real. He's unproven. He ain't stepping up. I don't care if, okay,
hey,
this person won in front of him, that person won in front of him.
Hey, check it. What's your name?
I'm Jermaine.
Jermaine.
Ask Better One.
Oh, Ask Better One was good.
What's up?
But you're calling in as if you're backing Fight Doctor, and that's okay. That's okay. But the argument isn't that. The argument is he's calling him Bum Lufkin, and that his opponents are tomato cans. Do you agree with that?
This is what he's saying. When he changed it from bomb to tomato can, this is what he was saying. His quality opponents are not proven. They're not fighters. They're being through trenches. They just fighters that are mediocre. They had a little spare moment, a little shining light for one little fight or something. But it's never nothing paying through.
Jermaine, hello. Is this thing on?
Dude.
Is this thing on? Because That is not the question. Are those fighters in that opposition, would you, forget Fight Doctor, do you categorize them as bums or tomato cans? Is Willie Monroe, Dominic Wade, Curtis Stevens, Daniel Gill, are those guys bums or tomato cans?
They are unproven for a seven-year pro in the middleweight division with 350-plus amateur fights.
All right.
He answered the question.
He did answer it. Listen, but I'm not going to argue. I just don't see it that way. We don't agree. That's fine. He got his
– Okay, all right. Now, let me get to my point. That's not why I called. But you just heated me a little bit when you know, because the man had points. You know, I understand, you know, but he got valid points. But –
But,
like,
Jermaine, are they not repetitive at this point? Are they not repetitive?
The fight – what the – The opponents?
The points
no,
that he
listen,
makes, man.
His points that he makes is they have a lot of substance. They have a lot of ground, Ness. You can't deny that, man. Come on. Triple G he's selling a lot of tickets. You know, don't get me wrong. He ain't pay-per-view yet. He's not a huge star. Why is he not a huge star with all the knockouts? Same could be actually Deontay Wilder. I look at him as the same. But you know what? Deontay Wilder ready to step up and ready to take a challenge from bigger opponents, not just cherry picking like kind of like BG doing, going after Canelo. Canelo's a smaller fighter. He should kind of beat him down the way like like Bernard Hopkins did, made it a catch weight with Oscar De La Hoya. Bernard Hopkins made it a catch weight with Tito Trinidad. Like Helen Schager and Sugar Ray made it 158 fight. I don't know if it was a catch weight, but both of them came in at 158. But my point is, he should have met him down the mat. Canelo never fought at a 160, and never even fought a full-fledged middleweight. So that's a kind of a cherry pick on GGG point with a 350 amateur background. Listen, look at, what's his name, Lomachenko. Dude had 400-plus amateur fights. Second or third fight, who he took on? Gary Russell, one of the best prospects it is. And both of them met. Then he took on Salido, a proven champion. He got his ass whooped, but he did it. Look at Rigo. Rigo went at Donaire on his 10th or 12th fight with that background. TG is almost 35 years old with 350-plus amateur background and didn't have one champion he beat. And you can't call him really a champion because he didn't even defend the belt. He won a paper title and didn't even get a chance to defend it as a champion. So you got to look at everything there. You just can't pick and choose what you want to pick from. I like GGG, but it's not proven.
All right, brother, listen. That's why you know the number, both on your phone and on Skype, and you got the voice of your opinion, my friend. We do have to move on. I do appreciate you, as you already know. Call in, baby. Keep voicing your opinion. Listen, Fight Doctor's always welcome, just like you're always welcome, but so is Wassam and so is AB. You got to understand that there's two sides to this street, you know, and I just don't fall on your side. I think Lemieux is a quality opponent. He's not a bum. Like, damn, even when I call dudes bum, you know I'm joking. Like, a bum? Lemieux? He won the title. He beat Ndam. Didn't he beat Ndam? Like, yo, he's not a bum. Like, that's crazy. Like, is he on a Golovkin level? No. And that's why people shouldn't be calling him Bum Lufkin. Because if Lemieux isn't on his level, but you know, come on, man. I mean, it's just so simple, and we do this every episode. It's so crazy, Fern.
I really don't get it. Trust me, I know AB's MO with Tom literally sounds like AB to me. No matter what we're talking about, no matter what you guys are talking about, it turns into the Triple G Bum Lufkin Tomato Can Show, and I don't get it. I don't fall on either side of the street. I'm in the middle of it. I understand both sides, and I see both sides. I agree with something that Fight Doctor and Homeboy just said right now. I agree once in a while with Wassam and AB. There are points where we could agree to disagree, but at the same time, it is fact that the main guys at 160 have not come to the table for Triple G. And he just asked right now, I think Fight Doctor did, why could a C-level fighter take the risk, but an A-level fighter can't? The reason why is this, and here's the answer. That C-minus level of guy, he wants to be one of the main guys. And to be one of the main guys, you have to dare yourself to be great, and you have to dare yourself to take on higher and better opposition. When you're the man, like everybody says Triple G is, you don't have to do that. They have to step to you, or you have to step to somebody who was on equal ground as you. Peter Quillin, at the time when he was undefeated, was equal ground. Because right now, who beat Peter Quillin is equal ground. There are equal ground opponents for him, but they don't step up to the table at the moment. That's something you really have to take into consideration. It's not the same old song and dance. It's an actual fact.
Hey, man. This is the world we live in. We're going to head over to where it's always hot, Corpus Christi.
It's me, Mario.
It was so hard to stay quiet.
You should have interrupted, man, because you're not using your camera, so I didn't even know.
Hey, I wanted to interrupt, but I'm like, you know what? Crazy. Let these guys get it out.
Yeah, listen, I'm not going to make it or stall things up, but I just don't get it. I don't get it at all. I don't see where they're coming from. Fern says he can see both sides of the argument. That's cool. I just can't anymore at all. I think that there's a difference between saying, you know, Golovkin's not that guy because he hasn't gotten a chance to fully show it, and to say it because he, you know, hasn't earned it. That's ridiculous.
Absolutely. But listen, let's stick with what is good news. Canelo allegedly doing $600,000. Buy or sell that, Mario?
I'll buy it. I think that it's we've seen his star power in the past. We know where he's at from just like a starting point. And so, yeah, I can buy that.
Now, why do you think that the haters somehow found the way to say 600 isn't enough or isn't good when, like I told Fern and some of the other callers and listeners, like, hey, isn't this more than Floyd versus Berto?
Well, it's because of Floyd, because Floyd has ruined, you know, people and the perception of people that don't understand the economics of boxing. And I'm not blaming him in terms of like it's his fault, but it is his fault. He made it seem like it was so easy. The things that he was doing, I mean, there were things that no one else could ever get to that easy. He made it seem like it was a reachable feat. You know, like if you grow up and you're in the gym and you see guys, you know, squatting 600 pounds and deadlifting 500 pounds, it's like you think that that's attainable. You think, oh, that's easy. I'll get there. That's easy. And when you see somebody doing, you know, 315, it's like, oh, man, that's bitch weight. That's a lot of weight. Just like those are a lot of buys. And review stars aren't just manifested. It happens over time. You know, everybody forgets that Mayweather was the B-side in his biggest pay-per-view until recently. I mean, when him and De La Hoya did it, that was on the back of De La Hoya. Floyd is the B-side. And so Canelo deserves those exact same sort of notions where, you know, Amir Khan wasn't the biggest B-side to date, and I think the bigger the B-side, the bigger the numbers, but those are absolutely respectable. I honestly would have loved to see what Floyd did with Amir Khan. It probably would have been higher, but not by much.
Now, you said the bigger the B-side, the bigger the number. That's my thing. Isn't Khan a bigger B-side than Triple G? Even though I answered this myself by ticket sales, but is that enough? Is Triple G a bigger star than Khan because of his ticket sales?
Absolutely. 100%. He's a bigger guy just because he's been on that platform for longer. He's a bigger guy because he has more PR revenue behind him. You know, he's just been in this position for longer. Amir Khan, he's never been that guy. He was that guy in the sense that, you know, he left the UK and he desperately tried to make a name for himself quicker here. He would have been much better off staying dedicated to the UK, because look what Ricky Hatton did. Like, those fans are loyal to you. Those fans, the UK fans, they're the ones that you want behind you when you step up to that big stage. And, you know, he I'm not going to say he stabbed him in the back or anything like that, but he just definitely did not cater to them. He lost it. So then when you are on your own in the American market, you have to prosper, and he could not. But Golovkin, on the other hand, he is prospering from all angles. What do we understand? We understand the big money, and in that the big revenue stream, which is sponsorship, you know, which is sponsorship deals. We understand Apple. We understand Jordan. We understand all those things. And Golovkin is in that position. He's primed to capitalize on a Canelo fight.
I agree, man. I agree. I'm interested in the facts, right? Because we got, you know, that guy who always says he knows what the pay-per-view's numbers actually are and, you know, that whatever numbers out there isn't true, saying that it's more like 323.
That would surprise me. That would surprise me far more than anything else. You know, and I don't want to say that that's not a good number or a bad number. I mean, it's obviously not the number that anyone would hope for, but I'm just telling you, at this point, Canelo has a mainstay figure. He has that number locked down. If it is low, then it's a reflection on where boxing is as a whole right now, not on the lack of star power that Canelo possesses.
Totally agree. Well, we'll see, man. Seems like the streets are really clamoring for this Triple G Canelo. They don't want to wait. I'm seeing, I'm seeing about Canelo and Lemieux, and fans are not happy about that.
No, absolutely. And, you know, a lot of people were not happy with us perpetrating that. And I want to make it clear, you know, a lot of people were saying that we were claiming that we were happy with that, or, you know, that's not at all what we said. We were understanding of that. We were okay with that for many reasons, but like everyone else, we want Canelo Golovkin right away. We want it right away. That said, it doesn't lose anything if it happens from September to May. And I believe in Canelo. This would be different if we were talking about a fighter who has a reputation of dodging the big fight. But Canelo has a reputation of fulfilling every single big-time matchup that we've ever wanted to see from him. He will fight the guy. And, you know, whether it happens in a few months or in a few months from that, it'll happen for sure. And it's going to be great no matter what. They're still in their primes. And, you know, an extra 4 to 6 months will not knock either fighter out of their prime.
And at the end of the day, it is reality. Lemieux is with Golden Boy. Stevens is with Main Events, who works with HBO. Like, those are opponents.
Exactly. Absolutely. 100%. They are opponents, and they are guys that make sense in that Golovkin buildup. You know, Ness, you always preach the similar opponent. And why do you preach that? Because it is the oldest way of promoting a fight, and it works. It's tried and true. At this point, you know, all we have are two reputations, but there isn't really anything other than the WBC belt linking Canelo and Golovkin together. Is it enough? Sure, but we can do better than that. The promotion can do better than that. It can capitalize. If these numbers with Canelo are small, then everybody saying that is assuming that, you know, that Golovkin-Canelo fight isn't where it needs to be, and it would benefit from more time being built up.
Yeah, man. You know, what I want to switch subjects to, since we're talking current superstar and now former superstar of boxing, is Floyd Mayweather and the fact that he's taking credit for the McGregor-Mayweather rumors that have been really on fire on the internet. Instagram has been, you know, nonstop artwork of the two. All internet boxing websites have posted articles about this. And now him coming out on FightHype.com and basically saying in a video with FightHype that he started the rumor and that he floated it out there himself, and that it's a possibility of him fighting McGregor and we seeing boxing versus MMA. Is this guy just like pulling our legs now, Mario? What's going on here? Is he promoting this Andrew Tabidi, Keith Tapia fight? What's going on?
Listen, when Mayweather came out and said that he was going to fight either Kareem Mayfield or Andre Berto, and then he went through with it, despite the fact that so many people were against it. That proved right there that he was going to do what he wants and that nobody was going to get in his way. I don't know if Dana White has the power to get in his way with this. I'm assuming he does, but I really do think that there's somewhere in Floyd Mayweather's mind where he's saying, this isn't a bad idea for me. This is a good idea for me. And you want to know whose fault it is? It's our fault. I mean, it really is. It's the fault of those who've said that we don't want to see Floyd come back, that there's nobody out there that's going to give him a test, that he beats everyone, you know, all those things that this is what he kind of has to, you know, go to in a sense. It's like, okay, well, then if you think that I'm just a circus attraction, I'm going to make it a circus attraction. That being said, I do believe that there's a part of this is true, but I don't think that it's reality at all. Like in terms of them being set up right now, not at all. There's just no way.
Well, let's hope not. Blackface, talk to me.
Good morning, good evening, good night to everyone listening to the live broadcast or past show in the future. Just want to make a couple of points here, all over the place, really. Not really. Some things are what you talked about, some things aren't. Just like to say that according to my reckoning, this will be your 350th radio show podcast uploaded to YouTube. So respect to everybody on that. Keep up the good work. In regards to Nesta, the Dominican Nightmare versus Sean Showtime Porter. Nesta did well, but I think he lost all the rounds. And what he should have done is just basically just tickled Brook to death. Sorry, you should have just tickled Sean Porter to death, just like Brook did. You should have just went teddy bear mode and just straight grabbed him, because you know he can't handle really people just grabbing him and you know, cuddling him and such. So that probably would have been a better approach. In regards to Canelo and Khan's pay-per-view numbers, their guaranteed purses, from my understanding from various articles, between them was only $5 million. So whether the pay-per-view numbers are $300,000 to $600,000, it's not like it's breaking the bank, so to speak, with them when their guaranteed purses between them and it only amounted to $5 million. But in regards to Mario Charm Bracelet just made a point in regards to saying that Floyd Mayweather ruined fans. I think that's the wrong word to use. He didn't ruin us. He spoiled us, because he gave us, he showcased his great skills and he backed it up with a great resume. And now everyone is being graded off them skills and resume in regards to his pay-per-view numbers. And now he's gone. He just basically is proving how really difficult it is to consistently get, you know, 800,000, 900,000 pay-per-view buys to in regards to Canelo and Triple G. Let me just say my opinion, when they do tango, I've got Canelo beating Triple G. The reason I've got Canelo beating Triple G is because I've seen Canelo lose fights and he's been given the victory. I've seen Canelo showcase a different amount of skills in the fights that I've seen compared to Triple G. I think he'll be bigger than Triple G when they do tango. So when that fight goes down, I'm picking Canelo. In regards to Triple G's resume, I don't think Triple G's resume is that great, but then you have to consider, to be these elite level fighters, you have to have the skills and also the resume. You have to have a balance between both. Triple G only really has proved with the skills. He doesn't really have a good resume. Out of all the top fighters, he potentially could just have the weakest resume in all actuality. But that's yet to be determined, because, you know, he's still got a long career and he can still, in the next 4 years, he could just dust off everybody, could beat Daniel Jacobs, beat Peter Quillin, move up, beat other fighters as well. So there's still time for him to do that. In regards to the Khan fight, just going back to that quickly, I just realized that Virgil Hunter was training three different fighters. He was fighting Andre Ward, he was training Andre Ward, Berto, and Khan all for the same time, and they all had fights, what was it, like a month, 2 months apart? Could that have played a factor in regards to Khan taking the loss that he did? Maybe Virgil Hunter was overworked in the gym training three fighters at the same time. I also read an interview where Khan was claiming he wants to fight people like Miguel Cotto and such, and he also said that he's not interested in the book fight. He believes, he doesn't think it's a big fight, but I think Khan, because he's been in America for so long, I think he's underestimating the UK fans. In my opinion, Khan and Brook would be bigger than Carl Froch versus George Groves at Wembley. You also know how big that event was. Khan and Brooks still is a big fight. Not necessarily the next fight, but maybe next year Khan gets another couple of wins under his belt and such. I think that could still be a very good fight in regards to that. I think he should come back to the UK in regards to Khan for these next couple of fights, maybe get on a couple of undercards, but I don't think his ego will allow it. I think he's got too big of an ego. He still thinks, you know, he still can headline cards and such. But like you said, someone made a point earlier that he kind of turned his back on, you know, the UK fans aren't supporting him as we did Ricky Hatton. Ricky Hatton fought in, you know, England religiously. He only went over to America for his mega fights and such. I think Khan probably did start doing that now as well. He's come back to UK, fight a couple of people, blah, 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 and then go back to America for the mega fights and such instead of just taking off, you know, these not very good fighters in America. In regards to people saying that Canelo and Triple G is the biggest fight in boxing, I think that Joshua versus Wilder in the UK on pay-per-view will also be a mega fight as well, because let's not forget, Joshua did 500,000 against Dillon White. 500,000 against Dillon White. Can you imagine if they do the right promotion, how much do you think Joshua and Wilder could bring? UK versus USA, two world titles on the line. I think that would be pretty badass. That could do a lot of pay-per-view views. That could even do potentially over a million, in my opinion. People also claiming that, well, not people, Sean Porter claiming that Berto is now top five welterweight.
Let's go. We need that outro, baby. We got a lot of callers.
Follow the innovators, not the imitators.
That's it, short and sweet. All right.
Hey, real quick, I just want to say, you know, he said it perfectly with the pay-per-view numbers. That's exactly what I was saying. You know, he expanded on it just a bit. Seriously, I love his call so much, but Virgil Hunter was overworked and Amir Khan lost. No, come on. That wasn't even worth saying. That was not why he lost. I mean, could he be overworked? Yes, but he certainly wasn't overworked, and that's why he lost.
Well,
with the blood of a Scottish warrior coursing through his veins, this man proclaimed,
I fucking love boxing.
MV2.
My
cheeks. If YouTube wouldn't have suspended us, the world would see that my eyes are shut because my cheeks are so high from the smile on my face, my friend. I'm happy to hear your voice. How have you been?
I'm very good, Nej.
Nej, you've been awesome.
I didn't catch you right there. You kind of broke up.
Nej, I just want to say that Mario. And all the rest of the boxing voice team have been on fire. But one thing I do want to say, Fight Doctor, calls are like a Scooby-Doo cartoon, man. You know what the ending's going to be. It's the same shit every week. So predictable. I just feel bad for the guy. I mean, has he finished his call yet? Is he on the other line or something, still talking? Fuck me, man. Anyway, I wanted to talk about Amir Khan. Amir Khan, everyone's saying that Amir Khan is so brave, Nez. He's so brave, such a brave guy, going up against a bigger champion than Canelo. He's not brave. You know what Amir Khan is? He's a coward. Amir Khan needs to fight Kell Brook. Now, if you know Amir Khan's last 10 opponents and Brooks' last 10 opponents, let me tell you quick. Khan, Canelo, Chris Algieri, Devin Alexander, Collazo, Julio Diaz, Molina, Danny Garcia, Lamont Peterson, Zab Judah, Paul McCloskey. Now, Brook, Kevin Bizier, Frankie Gavin, Jojo Dan, Sean Porter, Alvarez Rubles, Senchenko, Carson Jones, Saldivia, Carson Jones, Matthew Hatton. Okay, if you look resume-wise, Amir Khan, there's no comparison. Amir Khan's got the best resume, but the reason why is everyone's ducking Kell Brook. He's just like Golovkin. Golovkin and Kell Brook are the two most ducked fighters in boxing. The reason why everyone wants to fight Khan is because they think they can beat Khan. Khan's got a shaking. You know, Khan, they say Triple G's got Mexican style. No, Khan's the one with the real Mexican style. Because every time you hit Khan on the chin, he does a Mexican wave. He's a joke. All these guys, Lamont Peterson, Zab Judah, Julio Diaz, they all thought they could beat Khan. That's why they stepped up and fought him. I've got no respect for him anymore. Fight Kell Brook. There is no excuses. People are shitting on Kell Brook for not fighting the best opponents, but I feel sorry for him because he's put all his eggs into one basket. That's the Khan basket. And he's, you can see him every time after he fights, when he gets interviewed about it, all he talks about is Khan. I just feel sorry for the guy. He needs to get over it, but Amir Khan needs to fight him. You can't not fight him because you dislike him. In the past, that would be the reason why you fought. But now you don't want to give him the payday because you don't like him. It doesn't even make sense. All I want to say about Kell Brook is also, he is one shiny motherfucker. I don't know what Eddie Hearn does. Puts baby oil on him or something before he steps to the ring. But he's one shiny guy. He makes Jermaine Jackson look like Lord Snake. Lord Snoke from The Force Awakens.
Oh, man. He's shiny?
He's shiny. Look at the shine that comes off, man.
Listen, I didn't want to cut you off because I want you to just get it all off your chest. But you did say that everyone is ducking Errol Spence. And, you know, I had that really good interview with Eddie Hearn, but Errol Spence seen that interview. And I'm sure you've seen the tweets.
Of course, but, you know, I wanted to ask you, why is Errol Spence fighting another mandatory, another eliminator for the IBF belt? Who's ducking who?
I mean, according to Errol Spence, he said that the IBF ordered it. That's what his tweet says.
I don't know how you can go from being the mandatory and then you work your way into that position and then you have to fight another eliminator. I thought his last fight was for the eliminator.
It damn well was supposed to be.
That to me is someone's ducking. I think it's Errol Spence that's ducking Kell Brook. You know, the longer the Errol Spence leaves the Kell Brook fight, the more chance he has of winning it. If he fights Brook next, Kell Brook wins that. Absolutely. Kell Brook wins that. 3 or 4 fights down the line, I think Errol Spence would take it. But Errol Spence knows all the guys in the welterweight division, Kell Brook is the one you don't want to fight. Because, you know, Kell Brook is dangerous, man. He's a fucking bad man. He is an absolute...
I don't understand why Kell Brook doesn't get the same type of, like, hate that Golovkin gets.
Well, one of your best callers, Boxing MD, he could have a theory behind that. It could be in color. Because let's be honest. That's the only reason that Fight Doctor hates Triple G. That's the only reason that a lot of your callers hate Triple G. And it shouldn't have to be said, but it's so obvious. It is so obvious. But, you know, when you look at Kell Bredemy, there is no defence for that. What I would say is, Kell Brook has to get away from Eddie Hearn and he needs to go to America and he needs to start again. You know, he should pop in a tape of any mafia story. It could be Al Pacino in Godfather 1. You know, when he's a wee boy.
Too, you know, for me, like, at this point, And again, people are going to take my words literal here, Mario. And even if you agree with me, they'll do the same thing that they did last week. But like at this point, I'm willing to see like even Josecito Lopez. Like I just want to see somebody who is a barometer. Like I don't want to see JoJo Dan and Busy A and all those guys. I just want to see somebody, anybody at this point, man. Anybody.
The thing, Kell Brook is, he's going to be one of these guys who's going to have a lot of regrets in life. Because he's never going to get a fight until he's old and shot. Just like Joe Calzaghe was. It's the thing with these British fighters, if they don't go to America, they don't get the big fights. You know, unless you're Anthony Joshua, but even Anthony Joshua is not going to get older to come to the UK. He's not going to get the big American games to come to the UK because it's too dangerous. Ricky Hatton had to come to America to get the big fights. You know, obviously he got cautious, but he wasn't going to get Floyd Mayweather to come to the UK. He wasn't going to get Manny Pacquiao to come to the UK. You know, as good as the British scene is at the moment, 20,000 sellouts. If you want to get the American fighters into the ring, you need to go to America. And that's, Kell Brook has still not realised that. You fought after the Porter fight, the penny would have dropped, but it's not. So he needs to, I'm not going to take up any more of your time, man. I just think, you know, fuck Amir Khan. If he doesn't want to fight Kell Brook, retire. Because that's the only fight the fans want.
Queen Kong.
All right, MV Chill, man. Thanks for calling in. Been a minute. Joe from Indiana.
Yo, how's it going, Ness? Hey, man, that body shot put you down, Ness. Come on, man. Ness, you the Dominican nightmare. You ain't supposed to go down like that. Come on, man.
Yo, that was for the kids. Maybe it was for charity.
Ness, dog, you Dominican nightmare. You don't go down. No, hey, that was tight, though. Hey, man, I didn't realize how big Kenny Porter is, too, man. I was watching those workout videos. He was getting on to Sean, too, man, about not following instruction. But Kenny's a big dude, too, man.
Yeah, yo, did you see that Instagram clip of him taking all them body shots?
Yeah, that was dope. He said, no, it don't hurt. Hey, Ness, you going to try to get down there to Florida and do some stuff with Thurman?
Hey, man, you know that it's so funny that you say that. Fernando just dropped off, but he was talking to Thurman's people today, and they were asking him, did I decide on a day yet? But I have it, man. Look, my birthday's coming up May 31st, and I'm heading away for my birthday with my family. So I'll be gone till like June 6th. So if I can't squeeze it in before the birthday, it's got to be after. And
okay.
Yeah. And
I'm gonna drop a donation tomorrow, man, to help out with the trip, man. And nothing big, but I'll drop something, you know.
Listen, and I'm not asking for anything big. You see, I don't even fly to keep it on the budget. I go in the car. That's a lot of hours in the car to Florida. That's like 20 something, but that's the cheapest route. You feel me? And I gotta get that work done. We putting in road work over here.
Yeah, hey, that fight is getting a lot of buzz, man. I tweeted Lou DiBella last night, man, and just to get it, I didn't think he would tweet me back, but I asked about the undercard, and he said it's gonna be big, man. He said stay tuned. I guess he got some surprises up his sleeve. I wonder if he's gonna throw Quillen on there.
Hey, listen, man. The other day I said a rumor and I was totally wrong, and I don't care. See, I don't care when I'm wrong or when I'm right. So that being said, I don't know. I heard it might be Andy Lee and Daniel Jacobs on the undercard.
Oh, that'd be good. Hey, Ness, if you get a chance, man.
Porter? Yeah, Thurman Porter. The one, the fight you ain't coming to. The one you ain't booking.
Yeah, come on, Mario, man. You're supposed to book your fight already, man.
On that undercard, that's a great fight. It's already shaping out.
Hey, Ness, if you get a chance, get the caller Tasha online, man. She attended the whole Canelo fight last week, and she had told me that she had a great experience and she had met some great fighters up there, man. So she may call in. She said she was going to call in and share her experience out there in Vegas. But send me real quick, man. Going back with the pay-per-views, man, I'm thinking the reason why they're getting kind of low bro, it's so easy to stream a fight now. And then these Fire Sticks, these Amazon Fire Sticks, they flying like hotcakes. I really think a lot of people are just streaming them online. And, you know, people are like, why fork out $70 when I could just stream it for free?
Yeah, but Joey, my friend, and I'm going to leave his name nameless, he had a Fire Stick this weekend, and he couldn't watch it. He had to eventually buy the fight.
Yeah, I'm going to be guilty. I was guilty of that for that Cotto and Canelo, man. And after that, I never did it again. I sold that for it because I was like, I can't watch a fight like this,
That's what I'm saying, yo. I'm too bougie to watch fucking chippity-chop-chop streams, man. I ain't got time for that.
Yeah, man. But, no, that's a great show like always, man. But, hey, I'm going to give you props, man, because that had to be nerve-wracking, bro. You had all them people in that gym yesterday, and you know, people talking crap in the crowd, and you try your best to throw them jabs, and Sean is a fool in there, man. So that was cool, though, man. I like that, man.
I did not, Joey, thank you for calling in. Thank you for always supporting, brother. I did not know what to expect, I swear to you. And that being my first time, see, you guys are like, you know, a lot of you guys that listen, you're from the West Coast. You know, the boxing is like, you know, they put a boxing glove in your crib with the pacifier, you know what I'm saying? So it's different over here. Like, I'm just a street fighter. So I got up in there, and then you're right. It was just so many people. And then you got Eric Kelly. And if anybody has even watched one video of Eric Kelly, you know he is a comedian, forget a trainer. And, man, he was narrating that whole video and just taking shots at everybody. But, again, I'm extremely proud. It was my first time ever sparring, and I did better than everyone else. And I know they're going to get mad, but the bottom line is I landed more shots than them, and I got hit with less. But I did go down, I guess.
I guess it don't count
because I went down, right, Mario?
Worse. It counts. Yo, let me ask you a question. What did you learn or what surprised you the most? Let me tell you what I think surprised you the most, and then you tell me what really surprised you the most. There was a part in the video, and you can hear it. You like it's like everybody's yelling, but you can distinctly hear Ness say, "Yo, he's got power."
Oh,
like it was like this part where you realize that even if you've been hit before, nothing prepares you for a professional's punching power.
No, listen, it's not even the power, dude. I am more intrigued than ever for this fight just to see Thurman handles it, because the speed, the way that he cuts the distance between you and he could turn it off and on. Like, he was just playing with all of us, because I recorded all of them. Definitely head to the YouTube channel, and you can see Charlamagne the God from 105. And you can see
The Breakfast Club.
Yeah, no, he's from The Breakfast Club, but there was another one. His name is, I think, Rec, and he's from The Shadow League. There was a few, obviously, Barack from Sirius XM. So you can see all the sparring matches, not just mine. And, you know, listen, Sean could just turn it off and on, and it's like a football thing. And then I know people say that, oh, he's a football player. And you're right, he is, because that movement is no joke. But guess what? That movement leaves you befuddled. And we also have sparring of him fighting a pro, Cordell Booker, who's obviously – I mean, not obviously, excuse me, wrong choice of word. Who's actually a listener of the show. It was amazing to meet him and then, you know, have him say, like, yo, I listen to the show all the time. It was dope. So I can't wait to get him on. He's, you know, obviously a pro. And sparring with Porter, and it was difficult for him, but that was some tough. I mean, go check it out. I titled it Brutal and Bloody because that's what it is. These guys went at it. It was like modern day, the chicken thing in the ring, because they were going at it. But Mario, you had something? Mario? All right. Well, let's get out to these callers here. Looking for my guy here. Where we at? I don't even see Jose. Jose said he's on the line. Do not see you, Jose. Press 1, Jose. In the meantime, we're going to go to GT Kid from Atlanta. Talk to me.
Yo, what's going on, Ness, man? Sorry about the whole YouTube thing, man. That's crazy. But hopefully you get all straightened out soon enough. About the Khan and Canelo fight, man, I thought, you know, it went as expected, man. As soon as Khan got clipped good, you know, it was good night. You know, and it's nothing special. I actually think Canelo looked pretty bad in the fight. He was chasing Khan a lot, didn't cut the ring off well, didn't deal with the movement, you know, so. But again, we already knew Canelo's struggles with boxers. But what I really wanted to talk about real quick was Dominic Brazil and Gennady Golovkin. So Brazil, real quick, I don't know why people are hyping this man up. I mean, he looked like shit against Amir Mansour, got put down twice, and won the fight because Amir Mansour quit on the stool because he cut his tongue. I mean, if you're hardcore, you know that. You know, if you're a casual, just checks box rec, you know, you have no clue. But, I mean, he looked terrible. He's going to get knocked out in two or three rounds easy. I mean, so I don't understand why he's getting a shot in the first place. But I'm not going to dispute it if that man's going to take his shot. But the whole thing with Triple G just is mind-boggling. I mean, catch weights are really good tools to use for trying to get people in different divisions to fight, get big names in different divisions to come to some agreeable term so they can fight. And it makes good sense. Why people will keep coming, criticizing Triple G because he doesn't want to go down to 155. I mean, he's talking about trying to fight Canelo for the middleweight championship. And the middleweight limit is 160. And there's no reason two guys in the same division shouldn't fight at the division limit. I mean, Canelo can come in at whatever weight he wants. He can come in at, as long as he's under 160, who cares? And Triple G the same. And, you know, if you're supposed to be the champion of the division, you holding the belt hostage, you need to get in there and fight. I mean, if you're not a true middleweight, then get the fuck out of the division. I mean, I don't understand what the problem is. This man said he wants to unify the division. They offered a fight to Saunders. Saunders said it's not enough money. You ain't heard nothing from Daniel Jacobs in regards to Triple G. Peter Quill inducted him. I mean, you know, it's ridiculous that you can't – there hasn't been a unification fight at 160. I mean, I can't even think of the last unification fight at 160. That's the point. I mean, this is ridiculous. It's ridiculous. These sanctioning bodies are just pathetic, man, and it doesn't make sense. And this man says, I want to unify the division, and – everybody is ducking this man, and no one of quality will fight this man. And it's pathetic, man. So everybody out there criticizing Triple G, talking about he's knocking over tomato cans or his resume sucks. His resume does look like shit, but that's because nobody's getting the ring with him. I mean, I can't criticize them for that. I wouldn't want to either. I get it. But if you're a champion in the division, that means you're supposed to fight the best. You're supposed to defend your title, not against, you know, the likes of JoJo Dan, like Kell Brook does, or Kevin Bizier, or, you know, subpar B, C fighters. You're supposed to get in there and fight the best. Whoever's challenging you, whoever's at the top of the division. And it just doesn't happen. It's pathetic, man. It's ridiculous. But, I mean, that's all I got. I don't know how y'all feel about that. I know a lot of people got a lot of different views about it, but I just feel like it's just ridiculous, man, that no one else seems to – people don't seem to notice that enough that, you know – everyone's ducking Triple G, and Canelo's doing the same thing. And I mean, it's disgusting. Well, I hope he gets stripped.
We'll see at the end of the day if it's ducking. It's not ducking yet. It really is not. He doesn't. There was never a point where he should have been fighting him. You know, we're holding Canelo's title reign all the way back to Sergio Martinez. Okay, Sergio Martinez was being called to fight Golovkin, and he lost the title. Then Cotto was being called. Just because we've been dying to see him fight the middleweight champion for a long time doesn't mean that Canelo's been ducking this whole time. I will make this point, though. I want to say, people talk about the resume, and you talked about the fact that you look at his resume, Golovkin's, I mean, and you call it whatever you want to call it. But see, just looking at it on paper isn't enough. And that's, I'm talking about for everyone's resume. You have to know what you're looking at when you're looking at it. It's not just that he's fighting this man or that man or whatever, and you can call him a B minus or C plus or whatever, But what's he doing to these people? What's he doing to these fighters? He's doing things that no other opponents have done to these guys before. So fine, you want to say that these guys aren't the elite fighters of the world. And okay, they're not. But they're still world-ranked fighters. They're still at the top of their craft. You know, when you take into account all the people that have boxed, you know, and that people that they've come up against, and he's making them look a certain way. That's the way that you have to look at his resume as a whole. What's he doing to these men?
I agree, man. I agree. It is what he's doing. But pretty soon Canelo's got some explaining to do. It's just the bottom line. Mario, I know that's your guy, and, you know, you want to defend them, but, you know, someone's got to step up to the plate. You know, someone's got to give up the belt. Someone's got to do it.
Popping all this champagne, popping all this rosé, getting money like Jose, chain cold, Norway, 41 step full play. I'm like, no way, got a rocker like Coldplay, killing it.
Yo, Ness, can you guys hear me okay?
Loud and clear. What's going on, Jose?
Yo, first of all, before I get into my call, I just wanted to ask, what's the difference between Nestor Gibbs and Victor Ortiz?
I don't know that I didn't quit.
They both quitters, man. They're both quitters.
Yo, listen.
No,
quit for charity. I didn't want.
No, man. I
Yo,
was disappointed, man. I put it on my TV.
Joey spent
I had
all
the
that
wife and kids come watch. Man, I was disappointed, man. Disappointing. What else? What can you do?
Yeah,
no,
but
man,
imagine
I'm just bugging.
Then the fight is off, Jose. Then Joey spent all that money on hotel and tickets, and it's my fault. No way, Jose.
No, I'm just bugging, man. No, but that's pretty cool, man. What a moment, man, to be able to have that there. You're fighting with a world champion, man. So that's really cool, man. So, hey man, as much as we all hate on the Porters, man, I think, you know, you got to ride with them strong, man. So, you know, that's pretty cool what they did for you and the whole TBV army, man. So props to them for that. I just wanted to call in and talk about Canelo, man. That's the second time already that he said he's going to take off his gloves or he can put on his gloves right that second and fight again. I mean, it's getting a little tired, man. He's got to step up and do it, or he's just got to say that he doesn't want it because he talks the talk, but he's not walking the walk. So I don't know if you saw the fight game yesterday, but Bernard Hopkins said that fight has to happen this year. So D-Hop's already laid it on the table, man. So I don't see what we all benefit from seeing Canelo fight against David Lemieux or Stevens or anybody. Like, it's too big of a risk and there's no reward. So he's going to fight them. We expect him to beat him up. What's he doing? He's not marinating the fight anymore. It's not like the casual fan's going to get sucked in by him beating up David Lemieux. So what's the point of that? I think that's stupid. If anything, just fight him now, right? So I think he's got to do it. That should be his next fight. If he doesn't, then Canelo's just a talker and a bullshitter, man. And, you know, he's still going to get knocked out. Triple G's still going to beat him up. And it's going to be unfortunate because guys like the Fight Doctor won't give Triple G any credit for it. So I think it's just got to happen. Triple G's going to go in and knock him out. And then
Canelo card revoked, my friend. What are you doing on
no.
the show today?
Come on, let's keep it real, man. Like, you know what pissed me off? Like,
all right,
as soon as, like I was there.
You're right. I'm sorry. You're right. You're keeping it real. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was live at the fight, man. And to be honest, that was such a brutal knockout. My first reaction was, that's bullshit, man. Like, that's a smaller man. Step up. Triple G's here. Call him out. Let's fucking get this fight going. And he didn't do it. He gave us the same bullshit answer he gave us last time. So now I'm a little ticked off, man. I feel as if he's cherry picking a little too much. And now is the time where he steps up and he shows he's the real man. And if he wins, in my opinion, that puts Canelo at you know, top three best fighters of the last 20 years, man. That puts him right up there with Pacquiao and Mayweather if he wins. If he loses,
damn.
Then, well, if you think about it, does he not deserve that spot if he wins?
No, I'm not disagreeing. But it's just a big statement.
It is a big statement. And imagine that at 25. So if he wins that match at 25, man, sky's the limit for Canelo, man. And if he wins that fight, then imagine how big a rematch would be with Mayweather and me. Then you're getting to the 3 million pay-per-views, right?
the fact that he's 25, Jose, for some reason, I just feel bad. Like, I feel empathy. I feel sympathy. Like, oh, he doesn't have to fight Triple G. Like, he's only 25.
Exactly.
But I get it. No, yeah, no, not exactly, because he's the champ. And he's he's been fighting ahead of his time. So in sports or in anything, you know, when you're great, they say you were before your time. And if Canelo was that, he needs to prove that, get in the ring, and beat this guy who's 10 years his senior. There's no reason
that
for him
too,
to be great. This guy is 10 years older than him.
Yeah, and the worst part is he's talking about him. He's already said his name twice. So, I mean, what's he going to say the third time, man? Is he going to say, oh,
making jokes. Like, when is it enough? Stand up for your flag.
Yeah, man, absolutely. Hey, but on that, my last little comment, on that, you got to admit, man, what a great translation that Jerry Olaya did, hey, on that call. I think he made the moment by saying that, man.
Yo, even though it was a lie?
It wasn't a lie, man. He said meant.
Canelo
was what...
did not curse. Canelo did not curse.
He didn't curse, but that's what he meant to say. Like, no mamas means, like, don't fuck around, man. You know? It was beautiful.
Yeah,
man. I thought it was amazing. He...
I forgot what it is. It's almost like Tex-Mex, but it's like, it's not the word for, you know, we don't fuck around. That's not, like, the literal translation, but it's like a Tex-Mex. It was like slang, you know, and that's what it does really, like, translate to. He might have, like, taken certain liberties, but let me tell you, though, and see, this is where I get Jose's response, where he's like, oh, it's disappointing, like, he didn't really, like, go after him. I get that, Jose, I do, but that response, what he said, like, that was for the Mexican fans, like, straight up, the way he said what he said, the dialect that he used, the tone, like, all that stuff, like, that's what we've heard our everything, athletes, politicians, like, that's just the way that, you know, you talk when you're about to get grimy, and I appreciate it. Yo, I still get goosebumps when I hear it. I do, because that's, you know, but at the end of the day, you're both absolutely right. I cannot, Jose, this is probably one of the best calls, by the way. I was going to say this earlier, and I just, you know, Jose, this is one of the best calls of the day, your call, because you're putting it in correct, you know, point of view. And Ness, you're absolutely right. I mean, I can't disagree. You know, he can talk that talk, but at the same time, he's going to have to walk that walk.
Yeah, man. No, and Ness, but that's what the translation meant. It meant, like, that's what I think he gave, like, a real insight on what Canelo meant to say. Because so many times the translators just fucking missed the boat. And he emphasized it a little more. He took a little bit of liberties to push it a little bit further. But that's what Canelo said with his tone. He's like, you know, no mames, don't fuck around. Let's do it. So now you got to tell Canelo, no mames, and take it, man. Take that challenge. Let's fucking let's dare to be great, man. That's it, boys. Love seeing you guys and, you know, support.
Peace.
All great call, Jose.
All right,
great
Jose.
Call.
Thank you for calling in, brother.
Yo, real quick, Ness, I'm sorry. I don't want to keep going back to this, but I imagined us doing this on YouTube today and me being able to see your face. When I talk, I was like planning on doing like this, like.
But you can, thing. You could.
I can't see.
If
I
you turn
see.
Your camera on, I could turn mine back on. I mean,
I don't know why my camera's even off. Okay, but let me just say this, okay, or let me just ask you this real quick. So you're in the ring there at a certain point, and you did the Timothy Bradley, and I don't think you quit. I really don't. I think that if anybody's ever been like in that position, they know that your body's just drained.
Nah,
at that
listen,
point.
Listen. I'm gonna be 100%. I don't even think I was tired, but after I landed, listen to me. After I landed the straight right hand,
y'all listening to this dude? Like he's living off of that shit. Real
yo,
talk.
Yo,
go
bro.
Ahead, Ness. I'm
bro,
sorry. Go
see,
ahead.
See, Enrique just jumped on, and I can see Enrique. With the white tee. What up, Enrique?
Yeah, man.
All right, hold on. Oh, hold on. You always coming up with the Red Bull, huh? So, so after I landed the right hand, Mario, he whooped my ass. So I was like, oh, okay, that's what it is. So if I hit you, you're going to whoop my ass. So I'm not going to hit you. That's what I fucking happened.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? That shit hurt it.
Because my question was going to be, do you think that your physical fitness had prepared you for that? Like, the fact that what you've been doing
No, it didn't prepare me.
Right?
I'm going to tell you why, because, again, I never, ever, ever, ever sparred, so I never, ever, 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 other than football, used the mouth. So it was,
okay.
So it was hard right then and there to breathe with the mouth. That's another thing, you know what I mean? So, you know, whatever. I mean, it is what it is. Like I said, once the man...
Omega what's? Threes, sixes, nines. It can be really confusing. At GNC, we get it, and we're here to help. It's all about DHA and EPA, the good stuff. And GNC Fish Oil has more of it than any other brand. That's why it's America's number one brand of high-potency fish oil. Still got questions? Stop in and talk with your local GNC expert. Just ask. We make it simple. See store for details.
Let me feel some of the power. I say, all right, well, there's no need for me to get bigger than my britches when I am just a guy that talks on the radio. That's it. I know what I am, so, you know, I don't need to.
Hey, listen, all the credit to you. I've been in that position, and if you weren't tired, I believe you, but I've been in that position, and I've been dead tired. I was hurt to the body, and you just feel like you can't even – like, there's nothing that your body can do. Like, there's times when you're like, okay, move, and you can't do it,
you know? Let me tell you, I'm glad that I did it that way, because after watching Charlamagne, he came out there trying to be the god, right? Trying to throw punches, so Sean had to put it on his ass. And I'm sure he's feeling that today, because he got hit. I'm telling you, I got hit less than all them dudes, and I landed more punches than all them dudes. Charlamagne got his ass whooped. Sean was hitting him like up and down, up and down, up and down. It was crazy. Listen, that kid is fast, man. He's fast.
But did that moment, and you saw it, where he did that, like, over, under, step around, when you were trapped in the corner, right, on the left corner, when you're watching the screen, he did that, like, over, like, that under.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
That little
leg shuffle. What did that look like?
No,
what did that look like?
You don't even see it. You don't even see it. It just feels like,
right?
Like a snake withering by you. You know what I'm saying? Like a,
yeah.
You know, like you remember that old version of Anaconda, the one with J-Lo? The way that CGI was so poor, but the way the snakes would wrap around the person, it was just like that. Like, because I've watched him do that. I'm telling you, if you watch the Cordell Booker sparring, he does it to him and busted nose right away. Listen,
yo,
and he used that, if you think about it, that's how he hurt Bonet.
Yeah, you're right.
Yo, listen. Anyway, let's open up these phone lines. But before we do that, let's bring everyone's friend.
What's up, man? Yeah, I just want to say I feel fine, too.
Stay focused. Stay working, my dad.
I feel fine, too. I feel fine, too.
If you come to fight, then I'm going to look for it, man.
I feel fine, too.
I think you're accurate.
Yeah, man, I'm so jealous. Jealous of you, Ness, you know. Yeah, the Make-A-Wish Foundation granted you your dream. You had that fight. I wish I was there, man. I wish I was sparring. But yeah, I don't know, you didn't make it look easy. And if you did better than everyone, you know, Khan did better than everyone too. He deserves a fight of the year.
No. Ah.
For coming in there and making Canelo miss. Yeah, those pay-per-view numbers, man. Boxing is on fire this week, especially on the Instagram and on the Twitter. You know, you got The Rock tweeting about Anthony Joshua. You got
I know. I talked about that. That was so huge, right? We talked about that earlier.
Huge. And not only that, there's something
man,
else
you know, in a way, it's like I said, it was bittersweet, Enrique, because it's like, wow, that's so huge. And it's like, man, we're so desperate to be mainstream. Like, I know I am. I want our sport to be loved the way football is loved.
I mean, and then it was like the Charlamagne tweets about boxing. Like, he's a big conversation right now in boxing. You know, you got the Canelo numbers surfacing as low numbers, which is a disappointment to Golden Boy, I guess, and him. And the reason for that is what? What were the streets saying? Low numbers are because Khan's not famous enough? Or is it the pay-per-view is too expensive? Like, what if they just drop it back to $49.99? Will we get closer to the $700? Will we break the $800? You know?
I don't know, man. But that's a good point, man. Maybe that price point is I know it's bothering me, but look, we got a bunch of callers. Let's jump back out here. We got we got to go to this Skype call. He's been waiting forever. Cameron, talk to me.
Sup, Cameron?
What's going on, fellas? How's it going?
Good,
what
good.
Up?
Yeah, just quickly before I come on to my actual point, while I come on here tonight, it's nearly 2 a.m. over in the UK. If I wasn't sleepy enough, some of these callers hating on GGG, it's like a vocal sleeping pill, because it's the same shit every week. And I've been sat here astonished by the hate for him, because how anyone can call him Bum Lofkin and then sit here and say they respect him as a fighter, that's a contradiction right there, because if you're saying he's fought no one, how can you respect him as a fighter? Like, how can you justify calling them that? And then, Ness, when you call them out on it, they have to sit there for a while and think about how they're going to justify their own opinion. So, and I'll say this, since he debuted on HBO all those years ago, he's been wanting to fight everybody, you know, Sturm and Dam, Martinez, the list goes on. And another point, the guys from Kazakhstan, I think people overlook the work that not just Golovkin's put in, but his promotional team. You think HBO or any US network would have jumped to the chance of giving him a TV deal, an unknown fighter from Kazakhstan that no one really had heard of in the US. No, HBO took a risk, and Team Golovkin ran with it, and he's turned into a star. And I'll say one thing about his resume. Gil and Lemieux are former world champions. In fact, Lemieux was a world champion. Murray, Stevens, Proxer, Monroe, Rosado were all ranked in the top 10 in the Ring magazine when Golovkin beat him. It's not his fault. He's fighting at a higher level in all aspects than all of these top contenders and making them look worse than they actually are. Gil and Murray are no mugs, and Golovkin made them look like they were. And all the supposed top fighters who he hasn't beat yet, if someone can show me the queue where these guys line up to fight him, then you can start talking about it. But the actual point of why I come on here, I know we've got an empty pond in terms of fights this weekend in terms of attraction, but there is one topic I want to bring up.
Cameron, the same way you UK guys make us, listen to your hardcore fights, I want your pick on this Keith Tapia, Andrew Tabidi. Everybody has to make a pick on that, but you can finish your call, but we still want your pick.
I want Keith Tapia win the fight.
All right, cool.
But on the cruiserweight topic, there is another fight this weekend in the cruiserweight division, which isn't actually getting spoke about, and that's Bredis against Jurdola, which is an excellent fight. Bredis is the one who knocked out Manuel Char, who had a 30-pound weight advantage over him at heavyweight, which shows, you know, the power is legit. He's back down at cruiserweight against Jurdola, who beat Kudryashov. This is a fight that people should be really watching, I think. And the question I want to put to you guys is, I know in the US, the cruiserweight division is lacking that superstar right now, or just a general star that's maybe not getting the attraction to that division. I want to ask you guys, if you think that division is slowly coming into, I'll say a golden age, because we haven't had a unified champion since David Haye, I believe. We've had some great champions in the past, you know, Holyfield, Gomez, De Leon. This goes on. Now, in that division today, we have Levy Dev Ramirez unifying. We have one of the boxing's rising stars in Alexander Usyk, who, in my opinion, will go on and dominate the division. The division went quiet for a few years, and I feel internationally the division is growing hugely. You've got Lebedev from Russia, Usyk, Ukraine, Glowacki from Poland. So to go back to my question, you guys are in the United States, and you are lacking that star in the cruiserweight division to bring the attention over to the United States. Do you feel like we're coming into a new age in that division that it's lacked for a while?
Well,
I really don't. I feel like it's been at the top. Like there was this point about 3 years ago where you either were in on that little secret that the cruiserweight had some really great fights and really great fighters, or you weren't, you know, but it was kind of like a hidden secret. Now the secret's out. And so I don't feel like I feel like we've been coming into this golden age, but I still feel like we're not even there yet. I still feel like it can grow. It can get bigger. They can do more things. But from an American standpoint, I feel like an American cruiserweight won't even help the situation. I just think that when you got the light heavyweight division, what it's meant to America, even though I think it's meant more to the UK, and then you have the heavyweight division, I don't know. I feel like American fans are just awful. They really are. American hardcore fans are the best and the smartest people around. But American casual fans are just awful. And I just feel like they don't have any love, enough room in their heart for that weight class in the middle. But absolutely, I feel like we are coming into a golden age, but it's still got room to grow. I really believe that.
Well, let's jump out to these other streets here. We got Georgie Porgy. Talk to me, Georgie.
Yo, what's going on, guys?
What's going on?
Listen, man, I'm coming down, bro. I'm not going to be yelling at you guys because there ain't no way that I'm going to make any sense. I'm going to take it easy, man. Listen, we always go back to the same shit. You got to fight Dr. Cohen, Golovkin, all this and that. But what is the reason behind all this? We're talking about Wayne was in competition. But why he was in competition? Because the IBF got this dude ranked 10 when he don't belong there. When the rank, you say he won his way to that shot to the title, whatever, right? But he really didn't. Because if you got a so-called tournament on B fighters and you don't even count the other people in the other list or the other mafias, how could you even say this man is top 10? Everything goes down to the same evil, always and always. But now this guy is docking this guy, or this and that. Always an excuse, and we go back to the same. When this coming to the equation, bro?
Georgie, I don't understand what you're saying. So are you saying that they're not ducking Golovkin?
I'm saying that Wade and a bunch of people that Golovkin got on his resume, they're not really top 10 guys. The IBA may tell you something. The other mafia may tell you something, but there is no way. When you got done in the IBA after Porter lost to Brook, didn't even have him on the ranks.
So you're saying Golovkin is a bum because the people that he fights?
No,
are...
I'm not saying he's a bum. He's a great fighter. He proved me wrong, man. I lose king with this dude. I bet my head on it. If somebody can talk about Golovkin, it's me up in here, man. The dude is good, but his competition is not good. That be my problem with him all the time. And that's the fight doctor problem. And that's the problem with a lot of people got. That this goddamn mafia don't put in the right people in front of these guys. And then everybody else and the casuals,
Georgie, can you tell us who's your top five right guys Golovkin should fight?
Right now, they we are aiming.
Give me their name.
The Charlos, they can go up to one city. They can go there. Lara can do that.
Wait a minute. So you're saying that if Golovkin fights Jamal Charlo or Jamel Charlo, you're not going to be like, oh, wait a minute.
I won't be mad. No, hell no.
Listen,
back in the day, Trinidad won his first title when he was like 20 years old. Vargas, the Feroz Vargas, how old he was, like 19 or something?
When Gabriel Rosado moved up from 54 to 60 to fight Golovkin, the world got upset, man. Don't forget that. People have moved up already and you didn't like it.
Dude, but nobody knew these people. There's no way you're going to compare one of the Charlos to let anybody coming from 154 to fight them. They've been around for a minute. That when this guy went and fought him, he's not the same. When Rosado fought, nobody knew Rosado. What are you talking about? HBO was saying that the dude was number one 154 when he really didn't beat nobody. He didn't unite no titles or anything 154.
Yeah, when Rosado was number one, he was number one. You just don't know boxing. Rosado was hot when he got the Triple G fight. That's why he got it.
That's what they tell you, and you believe it, you keep on pumping it.
I was at his fights. He was fighting in
the
best.
Dude, the equation is wrong, Ness. The equation.
Ness.
That was 154. That was at 154. He was the best for Bundridge at 154because of his tear at 154 when he ran through Karras. He ran through Shakur Powell. He ran through, I think it was Whitaker. And then
it was
he got
all
the
on
shot.
NBC Sports.
Yeah.
So if you weren't watching it, then
and
you
what was that? What was Boo? What was Boo at the time? It wasn't Boo 154 too.
Yeah, Boo was 154.
Andrade wasn't 154 at the time too. He didn't be no Andrade. He didn't be a lot of people 154 ness. It's like
no,
bro competition.
Georgie,
if you go back,
Georgie, breathe. That's your problem, brother. There's more than one sanctioning body. I understand.
That's
you.
What I'm saying.
Relax, man. I understand you don't like the sanctioning bodies. I understand you think that they're a mafia. I understand. I also understand this is the world I live in. And in this world, The IBF, the WBC, WBO, and WBA all have their own top 10. And back
which is wrong. Which is wrong. And therefore, the question is wrong.
Georgie, relax, baby. Back then, Rosado was top 10 in the 154-pound division. Yes, he was.
By who? By all of them?
By the IBF standings. By the IBF standings.
The worst was the all of them. The IBS got the worst racketing, the whole thing, even worse than the WBC.
All you're doing is reiterating what I said. I said I understand you don't like them and that you think that they're a mafia.
So how you don't understand the criticism against Golovkin? If we already agreed that the competition, you know what these people telling us it is, how could you even tell a man to be calling his name everything?
We don't agree. We don't agree.
We don't agree.
No. No, Rosado was a good 154-pounder. Was he a good 60? No, not at that time. But he was a good 154-pounder.
He was.
And so was everyone else on his resume.
Listen, all the guys that you're talking about at 154, you're playing Monday morning quarterback. Because Andrade didn't do what he did back then. When Gabriel Rosado was making a name for himself at 154.
Andrade's still at 54, Mario. This dude don't even know what he's talking about. He lives in Boston. He should be knowing Andrade. He don't even know that.
Listen, but this is not what I'm saying. You asked me who can beat the guy. You didn't ask me. You said like 160.
I said give me your top
160.
Who Golovkin can fight?
And I'm telling you. You cannot go there. This is the same reason. But listen to me. Can you give me a second?
Go ahead.
Listen. It's the same reason why Canelo is on the 155 bullshit. The same reason. This guy can make it up there. They all can make it up. He's only 6 goddamn fucking pounds, my nigga. We're not talking about great numbers. All of them, they there with Golovkin. And we ain't getting none of these fights because of the mafias. And then you complain about it. Somehow you find a way to fucking solidify these fucking rankings that they make no sense. They never make no sense. These people cannot have somebody 10 on one side and then don't have any in the other ones. On somebody 2 and then not even fucking in the top 20 in the other side. What the fuck is that? It make no sense. Therefore, it's gonna be criticism, man. Stop it. The same way they talk about Danny. Oh, the daddy's talking about let it fight on Pepe. Let it fight on Pepe. He don't fight for glory. And then they call him a cherry pick, and then you try to defend that. Ridiculous, bro. But you know what? Great show, support, and donate.
So, Georgie, on your exit, I'll just say sanctioning bodies don't rank each fighter top 10 because each sanctioning body wants to be paid because you're right. I mean, not that you're right, but your thought.
Well, he's partly right.
Your opinion of them being a mafia, you know, maybe you're on to something there, but that doesn't mean that a guy is in top 10 because the IBF didn't rank him and the WBC did. That just makes no sense. Casual, does it make any sense? I mean, these guys.
I mean, one thing that I was distracted by was I overheard something. Like, casual fans are off when hardcore is the smartest. I kind of, like, frowned my face on that one because my favorite hardcore fan and the smartest is Dougie Fisher. American hardcores are the worst, if you ask me. They're always mad. They whine. And they just have no hope. Casual fans believe. You know, like some believe in the opponent versus the champion, or like, you know, there's a lot of people that would believe in Khan and go against it. We're hardcore fans. They always have the answer. They think they have the answer. And, you know, the casual fans fill in that gap that they miss out. So let's not call casuals awful, and let's not make this picture like the casual fan is in the back of the arena getting beat up. You know, because he's not. He's the guy watching the move, watching the
movie. No, but Enrique, but you
No,
know
Enrique,
what
you know where the casual
though?
Fan is at? The casual fan is usually on the floor seats because they
no,
want
no,
to get closer.
But hold on.
That hardcore's paint is like casual fans are in the back getting beat up or
yeah,
at home.
No. See, but you're misinterpreting what we were talking about, the cruiserweight division. Name a cruiserweight fighter.
Yeah, you're right.
Because you don't like the cruiserweight division.
No, because we're
not
blinded
that you don't
by
like
marketing.
It, but it's, no, it and brings. Why are you blinded by marketing? Because you follow the heavyweights, because you follow the light heavyweights. And my point was that the typical boxing fan doesn't – American boxing fan, does. I think they don't have room in their heart for a division between light heavyweight and heavyweight. And when I say awful, all I – and not awful is the wrong word. All I meant was that, you know, we're not going to get behind any cruiserweights. Casuals are not going to get behind any cruiserweights. And that was the only thing – it wasn't anything to do with, you know, pay-per-views, anything to do with welterweights or middleweight, anything like that. It was simply talking about the cruiserweight division because it is underestimated in most Americans' eyes. However, most hardcore fans have been calling the cruiserweight division the best division over the last 3 years. The secret's out. People are starting to understand and know that the cruiserweight division is by far one of the most exciting divisions in boxing, but it doesn't matter. No American fan will ever find room in their heart for the division. They will not pay for it. And that, you know, that's really my only point. And it's not to like point out casuals versus hardcores at all. It's really just to say that, you know, because look, hardcores, what are they going to do? They're going to stream it. You know what I mean? Like, so it's like, it's really the same thing. They're going to support cruiserweights, but not by paying for them, not by putting them on the pedestal. So really, it's the same thing. They're both awful when it comes to the cruiserweight division.
Well, I'm going to support cruiserweights because...
My man.
My boy, Keith Tapia. I was holding out, and sure enough, we're going to start taking more callers, but I am going to go ahead and make my pick. It's going to be Keith Tapia for the upset. Everybody's going with Andrew Tabidi because of, you know, the fact that he signed to Mayweather, the fact that he's a big, big dude. He's fairly muscular and stuff like that, but muscles don't win fights, man. Muscles
Listen,
don't
I
win
had
fights.
A conversation with somebody, I can't remember who now, and that's kind of embarrassing because it was just recent. And I had talked about the fact that if you look at Keith Tapia, he should be the A side in this fight based on the fact that he's the guy who's like really been handled best in the last, you know, year or two or year and a half maybe. Okay. Tabidi hasn't really, it's only a recent push. You know what I mean? But I'm going to pick Tabidi. I'm going to fall into – I know, it's stupid. But I'm going to fall into the hype machine. I'm going to pick him. All right? But let me tell you, I applaud Ness's pick of Keith Tapia. It is brave. And I don't mean brave like it's stupid, like he's going to lose. Not at all. I mean that he is making the hardcore pick right here. I feel like I'm making the casual fan pick in picking Tabidi. I'm falling into the hype machine. But
I don't even get it,
you,
though. Why?
It's a minor upset. It is not a major upset if Keith Tapia wins. Not at all.
It's not a major upset if he wins because, you know, Andrew Tabidi is the guy with like 10 or 13
exactly.
fights. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
But that just goes to handling. I mean, we'll see, though, right? Because you said you feel like Keith has been handled better.
I don't
necessarily feel that. Like, Keith just burst on the scene. It just so happens that we at the Boxing Boys know him because we've been covering him, but
True.
He hasn't been getting any TV fights like that. He just got on the scene when he fought out here in Trenton, you know, versus Garrett Wilson, which is a tough, tough dude. And, you know, I spoke to Angel Garcia. I spoke to Breadman, and I asked them about this fight, about Keith Tapia, about Garrett Wilson. I spoke to Ken Porter. You know, all before the lead up to this fight, because, you know these guys from the amateurs. They've been with them. They've slept with them. They've been on their teams. You know what I'm saying? And Keith is the goods. And he says that, you know, everybody's saying that Tabidi is too. But again, Tabidi's 12-0. And I don't know. Tapia has some movement, bro. He's got some good footwork.
He
doesn't have to bang, and if they've instilled that in him, because in a Garrett Wilson fight, I understand. Guys are gonna say, Ness, your guy got touched up. Yeah, he got touched up. He showed a little, you know, he showed that he got buzzed. But if he can box, he's gonna do his thing with Tabidi. Tabidi's flat footed Mayweather wannabe, and I don't mean that in a bad way. But that's what those guys over there do. They all want to do the shoulder roll. They all want to take one pace at a time at their fighter. And Keith Tapia presses the pace like I know that he will. It's going to be – listen, he's hungry, man. He's hungry, this kid.
Yeah, no, and that's a good point, because when you look at Tabidi and you put yourself in his shoes, first of all, doing that shoulder roll stuff and kind of falling into that kind of game plan at that division, no, guys are just athletic enough to find a way around it, and they are strong enough to make you pay for it. You cannot take grazing blows at that division. You really can't. I mean, these guys are essentially like old school heavyweights, you know, in that they are not these oversized heavyweights that we're used to today. And so I absolutely 100% agree. I mean, honestly, I went back and forth. I've been thinking about this fight for like the last 3 weeks almost, you know, and you know, casual, to get introduced to the cruiserweight division. It's not going to show you the best that they have to offer, but this Showtime card, it's got two really solid cruiserweight fights on there. I would consider both of them at least 60-40.
No, without a doubt, these are not the top of the division. These are prospects. And I think that Tabidi's being rushed into this fight. If he wins this fight, well, then damn, he's arrived. And if Tapia wins this fight, well, then obviously, you know, the world will take notice, because it was a Mayweather fighter that he beat. But to me, he would be doing what he should be doing. And I will say, I hope that he wins, because then I'm allowed to release not one, but two sparring videos that I got of him, which
Sadie,
is no joke, okay?
But,
like, the video is so bad that I feel bad putting it out, because I know, A, the fighter listens to the show, and B, the fighter's a good guy. Like, so, you know, it's just going to look bad. You know what I'm saying? Because.
Yeah, I mean, listen, it's our job. I mean, at the end of the day, we got to do what we got to do. And I'm going to tell you, regardless of what happens on Friday, because, you know, I mean, listen, if I get it wrong, I get it wrong.
I know.
I don't really
and
care.
I might get it wrong. And you know how they are with me. They go,
No. But here's the thing. We're talking about cruiserweights on this show right now. That's what matters. That's what Showtime's allowing us to do,
well,
and it's a great card, and I would like to keep doing that.
Perfect segue for our resident casual fan. Do you even know what's a cruiserweight?
No. I'm glad that we brought it up, that I'm blinded by marketing, because this cruiserweight is Andrew Tabidi versus Keith Tapia on Showtime. I just learned that. So somebody got to keep pushing that out there, and I guess that's our job, right?
All right.
Definitely.
But no, as a
well
casual
said.
Fan, though,
yeah,
name recognition. Well, like, you had to make a pick. I got the gun. You already know I got the 357 on here.
Right.
So you
better... Here's how I'm going to pick, and I'm going to sound extremely casual. Keith Tapia, he's down with TMT. Obviously, the king of boxing, even while he's out of the ring, believes in the guy. So I think I have every reason to believe in him. So there it goes. Brand in my face. I'm picking Keith Tapia.
You know, I'm going to just shoot you. Thanks. Because Keith Tapia is not with TMT. He's not being branded.
See?
It's Andrew Tabidi.
I'm going with Andrew Tabidi.
But Keith Tapia is Puerto Rican. So, come on.
Puerto Rican, Bobby. Puerto
there.
Rican. Yo, let me tell you something, though. Let me tell you something about Keith Tapia, yo. If he wins, he is what we need. He's like Hector Camacho without the – well, I ain't even going to say that. He's like
the
Hector Camacho.
No,
he can showboat.
No.
He can showboat, but not in the arrogant way, like in a make-you-want-to-back-him type
Pay
of
attention.
Way, man.
Yep.
Yo, go check his video. I put it out. It's right after the sparring, and he's like, Tabidi, I'm on your ass. That's the title of it. Check it out. It's a 6-minute interview. Get to know the man.
And let me tell you, casual, this is the best for you to see in terms of cruiserweight recognition, because, like, I don't even remember who it was that said it now. Jesus, I'm an idiot. That was talking about cruiserweights, and Cameron. It was Cameron. Of course it was Cameron, because he makes the best points. He talked about the influence of non-American cruiserweights, and those are the best cruiserweights. They are that right now. But – these are the guys right here, Keith Tapia and Tabidi as well. I think he's able to resonate too. These are the guys you want to watch, because these are the guys that are going to get that quicker following, I think. They're going to get quicker. If you had just like an average kind of like all-American guy, I think it would take time, and he's going to have to be great. Keith Tapia really doesn't have to be great right away to get people behind him. All he has to do is be fun, and he can be fun.
You know, right. I'm going to open up the phone lines and then get back to this Keith Tapia-Andrew Tabidi fight, because I'm going to try and get Sean Zatel. our Las Vegas correspondent, to jump on the show and just give us a little update, because he has definitely followed Andrew Tabidi extremely close. And you can follow him on our YouTube channel, because all of Sean's interviews and footage have been on the YouTube for Andrew Tabidi. So I'm sure that he, like I, has some sort of, inclination as to who he's going to go with based on, you know, that relationship. So I want to get him on here, not to give you guys a biased opinion, because obviously mine is going to come from my interactions with Keith Tapia and his trainer, Flex Sanquez, who are both stand-up guys, both come from where I come from. They're from New York City, you know. They both moved from New York to Ohio. Now they're back in New York. They was in Akron out there. You know what I'm saying? So these guys are my guys, man. These guys come from where I come from. I want to see them win. I'm not saying that Tabidi isn't my guy. I just don't know that because I haven't built that with them, you know. But Keith, declarated amateur. Stamp of approval from Ken Porter. These are all little things that you're getting to know so that you can make your picks too. And remember that you can use that Throwdown app, because I'm going to use mine. And it's the simplest. You ain't got to write nothing in or nothing like that. The fight is going to be there because they not stingy with fights like Box Nation was. And unfortunately, Box Nation sucks. Huge balls, because they're the ones saying that we copyrighted on them when they know they fucking lying. Because we ain't do nothing. But anyway, that being said, I'm going to open up the streets and I'm going to make sure I get Sean Chattel on him, because we got to get an unbiased opinion. We got to help each other pick who's really going to win this fight. This is an entertaining fight. This is two undefeated fighters, so we should support this as hardcore fans. We so badly want these guys to fight the best, Georgie. So let's support this fight. Jay Will, talk to me.
What up, man? Slow motion, man. Real quick, man, I'm going to talk about this Triple G situation, man. I thought the Triple G situation was over and done with, but this, we're still talking about it this week, man. I guess I feel where you're coming from. That's where you don't really, you don't want to hate on the guy, because he's shown too much to be hated on. But I keep getting this vibe that y'all saying that this guy is proven, and that this guy is, he's already a great fighter. Like, to me, honestly, no way in hell that man should be on the top 25 list for the best fighters in the past 25 years. And the best fighter he's fought was Lemieux. That's some bullshit. I mean, that makes no... It's too many other fighters that came in this game and done a lot more and fought a lot more tougher competition and did a lot more to prove themselves to be on that list over Golovkin. But is Golovkin a good fighter? Hell yeah. Does he got a high ceiling that we haven't seen yet? Hell yeah. Like, for instance, when he fought Lemieux, that jab that he displayed in that Lemieux fight, we ain't never seen that jab before. But that jab looked like one of the best jabs that's in boxing right now. And that's only because he had to fight somebody that he actually respected. Now, every other fighter that he had to fight, he didn't respect him enough to come through with a jab. Not even a steady jab. And that's the only reason, honestly, that fight really lasted to, what, the eighth or ninth round, because he had more respect for Lemieux. He had the same respect that he had for the other fighter. He probably would have tried to run through Lemieux a little bit early. And I think that's what a lot of people are upset about, is the fact that we know he's great. We know he's good, but we want to see him be great. Because we think he got it in him, flat out. We do believe Triple G has it in him, but he just hasn't shown it yet. So for all these Triple G fans to say that he's his best pound for pound and yada, 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 he looks great. He looks real good, but he's not proven to be great yet. Until he gets in there with another great fight. And that's it. I'm going to leave it like that.
All right, brother. Thanks for calling in, Jay Will. Jay Will, man, you slacking too. I ain't going back to you, but you from Columbus, Ohio, man. Tapia represents Akron, Ohio, man. He was out there. A lot of amateur fights out there. Lived out there for a lot of years, man. Step up your game, man. Slacking in your pimping. 901 Memphis, talk to me.
What up, Gimbo?
What up, Gimbo?
Man, shit. I want you to give me a gunshot, please.
I hope you ain't killing me.
Nah, I ain't killing you. I'm killing Mario. I'm sick of him taking up for Canelo, dog. And second of all, I'm sick of all these Canelo and GG fans. What they need to do is they need, one of them need to fight my top three, James Aguirre, Daniel Jacobs, or Chris Eubanks. Any one of those, if they don't fight each other, they can fight one of the three. Any one of those, there'd be some good fights because they all 160. And he do have the belt, Canelo, so fuck that. Tell me something. He 25 and all this bullshit. He got the motherfucking middleweight title. He need to be fighting top-ranked guys because they gunning for his ass anyway. So, I mean, that don't make no sense. And then nobody ain't ducking Cale Brook because he didn't want that Sean Porter rematch. That's what Ken Porter said. He didn't want it. So, I don't know what MV Chu talking about, post ducking Cale Brook. Ever since he got that belt, he's staying his ass over there and holding hostage. So, I don't want to hear that bullshit. And last but not least, I want to – Ness, I'm going to get on you for a second. You said you land that straight right hand on Sean Porter. But, nigga, you 6'5". You pulled and land that motherfucking punch. God damn it, shit. Ain't no doubt about that.
No, but you're not listening. I'm not saying that that made me great. I'm saying once I landed it, he whooped my ass.
It was over.
I learned not to land it anymore.
Oh, shit. And I want to be like Blackface right quick, and I'm going to get this quote, and I'm out, and I'm going to say it like this here. It's not an American thing. It's not a UK thing. It's a boxing thing, and that's all that matters, and I'm out.
That is a nitro. That's what we needed. That's exactly what we needed. We need to promote peace on CBV here, man. This is a platform for all to voice their opinions. New Jersey, 856, talk to me. Rumbling over there. What type of, you on a rotary phone, buddy?
Yo, I'm here.
Who's this?
This is Anthony Focus Parker.
Anthony, what's up, brother? I feel like I know you. We follow each other on almost every social media.
You accepted my request today on Facebook, I believe. And then you comment on my post with that 24/7 where Arnold Schwarzenegger drawn.
Yeah, man. And you got the don't you work out too?
Yeah. That's what the new focus is. I'm trying to become a personal trainer, trying to start a clothing line, get the gym going. So I'm trying to do some big things in the workout world.
Well, once you get that dry fit, that Anthony Focus dry fit shirt, swing that this way, you hear?
Definitely, man. I appreciate it. I just wanted to say some things. Even though you got Porter made you quit, you're still the best Dominican boxer ever.
Nah, man, Guzman got me. But yo, it was fun. I'm telling you, I don't know, man. I want to go another round. Not with him. With regular people though, because Porter's footwork, it was just too much for me, man.
Yeah, I didn't box, but I used to do some training, man. That's a whole nother level of working out. So I feel you. It's tough. Got to respect every fighter who gets in the ring. I just wanted to say real quick, I actually had the honor of meeting Amir Khan. I shook his hand. I accidentally sneezed in his face, and I knocked him out. So his chin ain't up to par if the sneeze knocked that nigga out. But he had no chance against Canelo. I don't know why they even made that fight. I think he had a good win off Cotto, so he should have rode that wave into a Golovkin fight.
Well, all right. That was an odd way to end it.
Let me assess Ness's performance real quick. All right. The thing that I saw I think the biggest problem that would have helped you the most is you were crossing your feet too much. You got it was like that shift over from left to right. But, yo, let me tell you, even though it was terrible footwork, you were circling so well. It comes down to timing when you're circling. A lot of people don't understand that circling isn't just the act of moving away. There really is a rhythm to it. And you had a really good rhythm. He could not really – I mean, listen, he wasn't trying to cut the ring off, obviously, at certain points. But you were making it very difficult for him to use his – highly superior footwork. And so I'm going to say it like for real, like, yes, it was probably because of the attribute thing, you know, you being so tall and, you know, all that stuff. But there were a lot of things in there that you did a lot. See, people don't understand that was your first time sparring. you did not look like it was your first time sparring. And that's why I'm going to give you cred. We were watching on the big screen and we were laughing because, you know, it was entertaining. It was a lot of fun. But once we really, like, watched it, we were like, man, you know, that's not that bad for somebody who's first, you know, time. And against Sean Porter to be, you know, for all that, man, it wasn't bad. It really wasn't. You had a good rhythm. I'll just say that.
Yo, and look, I know, you know, look, every time I say something, somebody got something, you know, say or they hate. But that being said, it felt good. And I've been going to these amateur shows with my amateur friends and, you know, been giving them direction. I just, you know, I feel like it's not that hard, man. It's not that hard. It's what's more hard is the actual training, being in shape, you know what I mean? But again, you know, the footwork. So I guess it is very hard because a guy like Sean Porter, yo, I mean, that's just too much footwear. I can imagine Keith because Keith is also light on his feet. I mean, it is hard. It's very, very hard, actually.
I'm trying to find it online.
Because you know what? In real life, I wouldn't, like, if it was real boxing, I would never spar or fight Sean Porter. So, like, imagine someone that was my size. It would have been a lot worse, probably. Yeah, so it's hard, man, you know.
But you would have been throwing punches that you weren't throwing against him. You decided to not overuse your reach
and
anymore.
That's the only reason that I want to do it again, because I feel like I was holding back because of Sean, because I always felt the fear, like, man, if you hit him for real, he's going to hit you for real, and this ain't going to end well because you're going to be asleep somewhere, you know what I'm saying?
So he neutralized you.
Oh, hell, after I landed that first, that one and only, right hand, it was a lead. Everybody was like, ooh, and he just rushed me. Boop, 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 fuck me up all on the road. I'm like, nah, I'm good.
I'm
going to
make a big deal like, oh, and then that dude gets pissed.
Yo, once they started oohing and eyeing, he rushed down on me, did the body work, folded me. I'm like, nah, I'm not hitting him no more. I'm going to just keep him at bay with the jab, keep him away. So that's what I was doing, up and down, up and down. But look, too many callers. We'll be back to that. We're going to go to Cut West. What's going on, brother?
Hey, what's up, Ness? How's it going, man? Mario and Charger fans. Hey, yo, man. I know you said keep the peace, right? But I'm about to go off. I don't understand how if you give Triple Duck even the slightest of fucking criticism, right, these fucking damage-controlling bumble-up cheerleaders are so quick to pull the race car. It's fucking disgusting, man, and I'm tired of it. And you know what's even more funny? Every time they call in with that bullshit, they have no proof to back what the fuck they're saying. And I hate to continue the hate train, man, but I'm tired of it, man. So, yo, Ness, I have to ask you a question, right? Do you agree with what Sam's notion that a particular group of people, a.k.a. black people, since we want to keep it real so much, do you agree that they hate, not dislike, but hate Triple C because of his skin color? Do you agree with that?
I can't agree with that because our show would be too small of a pool to take that sort of, you know, like you would have. I don't even know how to begin to gauge that. I can't, you know, that's his opinion.
Okay. Did anything Fight Doctor and the caller after him say anything racial about Triple C whatsoever?
Not that I remember. Somebody could probably find something. You know how people are. They could probably rewind the tape. I don't know. I would have to go back.
Yeah.
I think not.
So where's this dumbass narrative come from then? Where's the race in it? I don't see it. Where's it coming from? Nobody publicly came out their mouth and stated that they hated Triple C because of his skin color. So how is this a race issue if they can't fucking prove it?
Well, I'm going to put it to you like this. It becomes a race issue when we're talking about race. And what are we doing right now? We're talking about race. I get what you're saying, that somebody else brought it up, but it's like, man, we don't even got to talk about it then if it ain't an issue.
That's what I'm saying. If one guy brings it up, you don't have to argue the opposite side because you're only adding fuel to the fire.
Exactly.
Just
allow
that person to single himself out as a racist by being the only one that constantly brings up racist talk. It's just
that
simple.
Exactly. Like if somebody called in right now and was like, yo, Mario is a redheaded idiot, I'd be like, I'm not even going to comment on that. I know I'm not redheaded, so if you know that it don't come down to race, then we don't even got to talk about it. Liz, Golovkin's got black fans. Anybody out there that think he doesn't have black fans, y'all are crazy. He's got black fans, and guess what? A lot of them call this show, too. Everybody focuses on the few people that call and make these distinctions, but the truth of the matter is Golovkin's got all kinds of fans. He really does, as does Canelo, as does Mayweather. Man, I know more Hispanics that like Mayweather than I do any other people. Like, that's just and that's not fair because I do know more Hispanics than any other people, but still, you know, it's there's love out there, there's hate out there.
Yeah,
is what it is.
Speaking of love, Ben Umar hit me up and says, yo, you did good in Spawn. We got to get up. I'm your size. Getting called out. You know what I mean? I ain't ready, though. I ain't ready, man. Yo, listen, I can't last them rounds, man. I can't. I'm telling you. Not with punches hitting me, casual.
You're sounding like Canelo right now. I ain't ready.
I'm not. Hey, listen.
Oh, shit.
Hey, I never claimed to be a fighter. You know, I never claim to be a fighter.
I'm watching your sparring right now. That shit is kind of fun.
Yo, you know what's funny? I got more views than Charlie Mann.
Long Beach in the house. Yeah.
Hey, JP's fucking dropping the ball, JP. JP,
hey, man, I'm here. Hey, but, just to speak to the Golovkin thing, man, y'all got to excuse me, I'm at the gym, but I just think it's a cultural divide, you know, and it's like when Mario said he was the best rapper. Nobody, all the black dudes, we came for him, including myself, because in the hood, you can't say you the best at nothing. You got to prove it. So if Ness, you was playing ball, when you was playing basketball, and you said, yo, I'm the best at basketball, cats was going to be coming for you. You know what I mean? So that's what I just think is very simple when it comes to Golovkin. But I had written some really critical articles about him lately. And so I decided, let me see what these guys are talking about since we have this divide in the consensus of opinion when it comes to him. So I said, okay, let me go check it out because I'm a part of the demographic that's saying he hasn't fought anyone. So I did some research, and this is part of the divide. The guys that are the slow mo's, the black guys per se, we ain't going to go do that research. We ain't going to go look at 20 of his amateur bouts. But let me tell you what happens when you look at 20 of his amateur bouts. You start to side with those Golovtards or whatever, because then you're able to see what exactly they're assessing. Because we're just judging them on what have you done for me as a pro. They're going back doing the research since the sample size as a pro isn't that big. They're going to go look at the larger sample size, which is his amateur career. And let me tell you, that guy, man, I don't know. I'm not sure if I've ever seen a fighter like this dude. And I'm self-proclaimed Captain Flo-Mo. You know, the right hand, it's like magnetized to dude's faces. He don't miss. I mean, his prowess, you know, just ring generalship. He can change at any time. And you guys know I've been on record several times being highly critical of this guy. And I'm telling you, when you go do that homework, man, I'm not sure that I've ever seen a fighter like this in my life. And I'm, you know, you don't see this power mixed with ring intelligence and know-how and just he got the eraser alongside it. You know, and it's to the point where a lot of his amateur bouts, the guy actually was playing with dudes a lot of times, dude. And we're talking about against some of the higher competition. You got your Darrells out there. You got your Blue Tape Light.
Wait a minute, JP, because to some, they might have already fell in some sort of trance and they don't even know what they're hearing or – are we hearing some sort of breakthrough from you? Are you like a Golovkin fan now? I mean, because I don't understand what I'm hearing. It sounds like you're serious.
You're serious.
Like all of a sudden.
Thank you. This is my present for everybody.
This is
thank
big,
you, my
big, the best present what? For everybody, for TV, for my fans, for everybody, for boxing.
Are you on his side now?
Look, I always been a fan. I never said the dude was could not fight like all the other black dudes never say. We never say that. We just say he ain't fought nobody, period. You know, it's just that simple. But if you go do assessment.
So I gotta ask you the same thing I asked Fight Doctor then. Are you saying that the guys that he's fought are tomato cans and bums?
Well, dude, I live in Los Angeles. I live right by Inglewood. That fucking Dominic Wade, you could pull up to any basketball court and find him. How the fuck are you 160 and fat? And you 6'2"? That's ridiculous. So that guy, that man, that was deplorable what we had to watch, that Dominic Wade bullshit. Yes, so I'm saying the guys he fought, not all, but most, they aren't elite. They're not elite. And a lot of them are like on the backsides of their careers, and they were just names. They were resume fillers. There's look, I beat Macklin. Look, I beat DeGale. But we all know them dudes was on their last legs. Rubio of the world. Do you know what I mean? But if you just critique in-ring attributes and things like that, I'm telling you, man, and cats need to go. It's easy to find it on YouTube. It's not hard to find. Go look at some of Golovkin's amateur bouts. And you guys tell me, have you seen some shit like this before? And I'll still say he ain't fought nobody, and I don't think he should be the P4P because he ain't fought nobody. That's how P4Ps are go. They are ranked on who you've beaten. But if you assess the skill, I am not sure that I've ever seen anything like this. Real quick before I go, guys, since it's been a while, Canelo Khan, that was just terrible. I quickly realized by round two, by the way, I had Canelo up 4-1. And I quickly realized by round two, Khan had no idea of what to do. And this is a learning experience for everybody. Just because you're fast don't mean you can do what Mayweather does. Just because it's a learning testament for us all to know that just because your hands might be faster and you can move faster, the attribute of having ring intelligence is probably far underappreciated, and that's what Khan didn't understand. And I feel like Virgil or somebody should have told him, just because Khan honestly believed in his heart that he could beat Mayweather. So he looked at it like, well, if Mayweather could do that, I can do it. And boy, was he wrong, and he had to get his ass knocked flat. And I think he realized that now, but it took his ass to get damn near killed before he realized it. Y'all have a good one, man.
All right, JP, thanks for calling in.
Ness, you think that sound right, that Khan didn't know what to do, or was it just Canelo landed a strong shot and his chin is glass? He really does have a weak chin. Because I think he really does have a weak chin.
I think right now I'm going to just continue to be Ness and be honest, but I know that I'm going to be hated for being honest at this moment, because right now Khan is some sort of patriot, right? He's like being paraded around his city as a war hero for taking this fight and losing,
right?
But at the end of the day, you know,
fight of the year.
All I see is the same chin I've been seeing, and we all knew he hadn't been knocked out up until this point because he was staying away from punches. You know what I'm saying?
Right. So he did know what to do because he looked good for four rounds, and he got hit. That's how I see it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it is what it is. Mario, what about you? And he's not there.
Mario went to sleep.
Exactly. But what else do we got on the docket? Because there is a couple of things that we could talk about. Oh, you know, the Brooke Vargas unification is getting very close. And look, I like this. And that's cool. I like this. I like this fight. I just don't know if Vargas is the guy that's going to beat Brooke.
It's a name. For the resume,
it is a name. It is a name. It is a name. Is it a sexy enough name? Is it a name? I don't think it's a name that puts danger. You know, I don't see Brooke losing this fight. I just can't. Like, I know he knocked out Saddam Ali, but do you think that Brooke is Saddam Ali? I don't think anybody's going to think Brooke is Saddam Ali. Mario, do you think Brooke is Saddam Ali?
No, not at all.
How sexy is this fight for you?
Very, because it's something that we didn't think would happen. or not didn't think would happen, but it wasn't on the radar for sure. And these guys were like in two separate worlds. I mean, it's almost like seeing like a Marvel character face off against a DC character. You know what I mean? So I like it a lot. And from a style standpoint, it provides a lot of interesting dynamics.
I know
cheap
it's pretty
plug,
sure.
Cheap plug. Don't forget to hit up www.lootcrate.com/TBV because like Mario said about the Marvel versus DC, this month's Loot Crate is Marvel themed Avengers, Warcraft, Dragon Ball Z, and the movie Power. So if you just sign up just for this month, just for the $20 subscription, using that www.lootcrate.com/TBV link, you'll save $3, so it'll only be $17, plus you'll get a $45 to $75 value, which you'll get an exclusive T-shirt that you can't buy anywhere because it's exclusive to Loot Crate and, you know, TBV listeners, obviously, plus an action figurine to go themed with whichever one they decide to pick. You know, it could be either Avengers, Ultron, anything that falls in that realm, Warcraft, Dragon Ball Z, all that power. Remember, lootcrate.com/TBV, $3
off. And it's
off.
Every month, by the way. And
it is every
month.
Time.
That's the thing. Like, you can keep waiting it out and seeing what gets better. It gets better, whatever, you know. And it's not even better. Better is the wrong word. It's going to get precise to you.
Exactly.
So it's like, if you weren't happy with, you know, a specific thing, it doesn't matter because the next month, like, it could be literally tailor-made to you. So, you know.
And if you want to get, you know, you want to get all sexy and get your girl one, because there's loot crates for pets too. You can get your dog a loot crate, and every month your dog will get in a little exclusive crate for him too. But there's also a female version. So definitely use my link to check it out and decide what you want. But I know that us boxing fans, we love superhero movies. And right now with Civil War just being out, May being the month for big Marvel movies and DC movies, no better time to get on this loot crate and get something exclusive that you could only get through this TBV offer. That
Loot
being
crate.
Said.
Sounds good. But real quick, Brooke Vargas, welterweight unification deal, right? Be honest, though. It's premature, but you know who's going to win.
Yeah. That's exactly what I meant by this fight not being so sexy, because I think, like, and that's sad because, you know, Vargas shouldn't be like an underdog, right? Like, he had a good fight with Saddam Ali where he knocked him out. And if you're really wishing on a star, then you thought he did good in the Bradley fight because of the last round, right? I don't know.
Right. He should have rematched Saddam Ali.
I don't think it's that.
Whoa.
What are you going to call it? Like a.
Let me just ask him this quick question. So, Casual, you want Jesse Vargas to rematch Saddam Ali?
Yeah.
But
I
why?
Mean,
there's no reason.
Then there's no reason. But, you know, then what was the reason for Berto Ortiz?
They had a really great fight. It was
Saddam Ali is a praised fighter, celebrated fighter to that fight. Now all of a sudden we forgot about how good he was. Wasn't Saddam?
Man, that was his coming out party, though, to a degree. I mean, it would have
I understand you.
Fight that he did the most.
I understand you, Casual. He still is good. But he didn't do enough to merit.
To warrant a rematch,
yeah.
Okay.
You got to do something. See, the Berto Ortiz, that was back and forth. You knock me down,
fight.
I knock you down. Yeah, we deserve a rematch. But, you know, Pacquiao Mayweather.
Like a split decision, you know, if there was a controversy, if there was, like, multiple knockdowns, that's one thing. But listen, I don't think that – see, where I think you're right is that Saddam Ali could still – turn it around to where, like, in two fights, we're demanding a rematch. You know what I mean? Like, he could get back at him. He's got to go back to the back of the line. That's the way it is. But the way I'm seeing it is, like, what are you calling this fight then, Ness? You're saying Brooke is, like, 80-20?
Man,
80?
No, listen. I'm not going that deep. I'm just saying 60-40. I'm saying – I'm not even saying percentages. I'm saying Brooke is the favorite and should win.
Sure. Would you be shocked if we're on a Sunday show where Vargas won?
Hell yeah.
I would.
Really?
I think that Kell Brook is sharper of the two. I think that, you know, Vargas is a little basic. He's always waiting for the big right hand. You know, he kind of bobs and weaves to the left and to the right, but very slowly. I think that Brook is going to pick him apart. He's going to be at the end of Brook's jab and right hand all night. Brook's too big. He does way too many pull-ups. The kid's got the V going on all day. Nah, man. Nah, this is nightmares for Vargas. But he's there to be great. If he loses, I'm going to big him up all the way, because he's probably going to go to the UK and he's trying to unify. This is dope.
Yeah, it is. I just like the fact it's unification. It's great.
Yeah.
Welterweight division.
Let me jump back out to the phone lines. I got two surprises for you guys. We just might get Sean Zatel so he could give us the little inside goodies on Andrew Tabidi right before we make our official picks. And I'm in communications with Keith Tapia and Flex themselves. They just got out the weigh-ins. You know these guys want to eat. Let's see what they do. I mean, it is TBV, though, right?
This is TBV. Get him a body bag.
Hey, now are you walking in the ring? Number one.
215, talk to me. Who's this?
Yes, what's going on?
JP?
Yep, JP the politician.
What's
going
on, brother?
Yo.
Another day, another podcast.
I hear that. I want to talk about these Canelo numbers. $7.4 million at the gate. Has Triple G ever even surpassed $1 million at the gate? If you could look at that up at a later time, because I'm not sure if he has.
No,
I know he sold some tickets.
Let me just tell you, I'm going to give you a disclaimer, JP. I don't have my producer here, but I know that 818 number, and that's AB. So be careful what you say. Because...
Well,
you know,
let him do the research, because I'm not sure. I'm asking a question.
There, and this guy really does do the research.
Let him do the research then, because I don't know the answer to that question, but I know he never did 7.4. Probably never even did 3.5. He ain't done half of what 7.4 is. So let's fall back on trying to make the comparisons to Canelo and Triple G in terms of earning power. Look, 600,000 buys to fight Amerikan, who has absolutely no earning power, has no track record of selling anything, who did a fight in Las Vegas against Devin Alexander, and 4,000 people might have came out for the fight. It was all Canelo. It was all on Canelo to sell the pay-per-views, to sell the tickets. So 600,000 tickets, that's a lot of tickets. That's a lot of pay-per-view buys. So I don't see where people are trying to come up with these, speculation in terms of Canelo meowing these little G. I don't understand that. I don't understand that at all, because 600,000 is a lot. Now, I want to move on to Virgin Hunter, because I haven't been able to discuss what this guy did after the end of the fight with Canelo and Khan. This guy, I mean, he continues to put himself first in terms of a lot of his boxers. What he did at the end of that fight was deplorable. All throughout the process, he was calling Canelo names, saying Canelo's not any good, how Amir Khan was not only going to outbox Canelo, but he was going to knock out Canelo. And then after he slumps Khan, puts Khan to sleep, he don't even go get his boy off the ring first and go take his boy to the hospital. He got a whole lot to say about making a fight with Triple G and how Canelo needs to move up to 160 to fight Triple G. When Andre Ward, did Andre Ward cut that weight to come down to 164 to fight Triple G? See, it goes both ways. So he should have minded his business and stayed out of the situation with Canelo and Triple G, because he all in his feelings. He all sweating, he all screaming, he all yelling, he's doing all that stuff. It displayed who Virgin Hunter really is. He really needs to go and get some, because he got real issues going on with himself. He needs to stay out of other people's business. Now, in terms of Triple G and being next, I don't see him being next. When I look at these pay-per-view sales, that tells me Canelo can sell fighting anybody. So the way I would do it if I was Golden Boy, I would have Canelo fight Gabriel Rosado next. And then after Gabriel Rosado, later on in December of this year, because I believe Canelo's going to do three fights, I would have him fight David Lemieux at 160. So I would give him a progression. Maybe the next fight against Rosado at 157, and then you move up 160 to fight Triple G. To fight David Lemieux at the end of the year. And then Cinco de Mayo next year, then you can fight Triple G. So I think that's a real good actual program to put Canelo on, because at the end of the day, Andre Ward, as he moved up to 168, moved from 168 to 175, he took two or three tune-ups, and he took a progression and moving up in weight. So, like I said, Hunter, he really should have stayed out of it. He really should have stayed out of it. But, like I said, I think 600,000 buys is plenty.
So do I, JP. So do I, man. Thanks for calling in. Go ahead, Myra.
I just want to make this one point. Listen, I don't know why we're talking about comparison. I don't know, like, where that came from. Maybe there are people comparing. That's fine. But I think it boils down to one simple question. Who does Canelo do, like, theoretically, who does Canelo do more money with? Like, would he stand a chance to sell more pay-per-views if he fought, like, Jermell Charlo? Would he stand a chance to sell more pay-per-views if he fought, like, Danny Jacobs? You know what I mean? Like, Golovkin is the guy. Like, maybe he doesn't compare with them, and that's fine. Maybe he does. We don't know. But at the end of the day, he makes more money with Golovkin. That's just the bottom line.
Right. Mario, really quick, no homo, your traps are serious. secondly, he could fight Rosado and do like 325, 350 on September 17th without a problem on pay-per-view.
On a pay-per-view?
Hell yeah.
Sure.
That's the average number for any fight, though.
No. No, because Marquez Bradley did like 250, you know. Marquez versus like what's that kid's name? Your boy out there in Texas? They did like 225.
Oh, Diaz.
Yeah.
That was pay-per-view?
Bernard Roy Jones was atrocious. Part two.
That was like 50,000, that one.
Yeah.
Another comparison, though, Triple G ticket prices are lower than Canelo. So, of course, he's going to make
that is a big deal. They do be having a little $25.
Promoters promote,
$10
and that costs money. And let's not forget, Canelo flies around in a jet. So, you know, we're going to put that on those tickets. So let's not be fooled by that.
Sean, I see that you said you're on. Can you press 1, sir? Kind sir. See if he can get this right, this guy. Poor guy.
And real quick,
one day the Lord's going to bless us with a studio where Sean will just be, whoop, he'll come in on via Skype like
hologram.
Like my man Rayfield does. Sean, is this you, sir?
Yes, sir.
Now listen, I'm gonna bring you right into why I wanted you on. Right now, obviously, I am East Coast, you are West Coast. I am all in the Keith Tapia camp, both trainer and fighter. I've gotten to see things that people don't get to see. I've been following him for a very long time, and he's only 17-0. I know all that. You've been doing the same with Tabidi, so I'm assuming you're going with Tabidi. Maybe you're not, but we want to know. TBV has been, you know, covering Tabidi on behalf of you for so long. I wanted to get your take and let our listeners know so that they can also, you know, get my half, get your input, and then come together and get their own ideas who they should pick.
Well, it's funny, Ness, because this is kind of just a case of East Coast, West Coast thing, because I know, I guess you are going with Tapia, and you were right, I am going with Tabidi. I don't know how much you've got to see with Tabidi, maybe a little more than I've seen with Tapia, because he has the Mayweather name behind him. But I haven't really got to see Keith Tapia fight. I'll be honest, when I first heard of the fight, I thought, who's this cat? Is this someone they're just bringing in to break Tabidi into the rankings? Because we all know it's for a regional belt. The NABF gets you into the top 10 of the WBC. And then I looked up his record about a couple weeks ago. He's 17-0. It seems some of the things you're covering with him. And I find out he's another young, undefeated guy like Tabidi. So we have a real fight on our hands tomorrow night here in Vegas. I'll be covering it for TBV, of course. But I'm going with my local guy, like I'm sure you are, Ness. Tabidi, he's in a division that's wide open, cruiserweight. And he, even though he's a big man, 6'2", 6'3", 200 pounds, he's got the skills and the speed and the agility of a welterweight, of a middleweight. He can move and punch and has speed like a smaller guy. So I've always been impressed with Tabidi, and I think he'll win tomorrow night. But that's more, like you said, me going off my guy, what I've seen out here in Las Vegas, than because I haven't seen too much of Tapia. So I think Tabidi gets the job done tomorrow night.
That's exactly what I wanted. So now let me ask you some questions. Maybe you can ask me some if you have any. I don't know, whatever. My thing is, I think Tabidi is like a overweight Mayweather. Not overweight, sloppy fat, but like a bigger version of Mayweather is what he's trying to look like in the ring. He does the shoulder roll. He takes that one pace step at a time. Are you telling me that he can change gears? He can back box off the back foot, be a counterpuncher? I mean, does he have levels, or is he just this guy that takes one pace, kind of like Broner does at times, and comes towards his fighter?
No, you're right about that. He does seem to definitely try and copy the Mayweather style, fight in the same stance. But he's obviously there's only one Floyd Mayweather, but he's sharp. He's sharp like Floyd is. His punches are nice and straight and accurate, and they're crisp and fast. Like I said, like a guy who's not in the higher weight classes, like a guy who's smaller, and he can move around the ring. So far, all he's been doing is walking these guys down and knocking them out. I imagine he won't be able to do that with Keith Tapia. So to answer your question, yeah, I do think he has levels, gears in his game. I think he'll show more. I think we will see him move a little bit around the ring and box and showcase more things than he. But Ness, what can you tell me about Keith Tapia as someone who's like a lot of fight fans out there who hasn't been able to see him do his thing in the ring? What kind of fighter is he, and does he got a lot of talent? Does he got that it factor, explosiveness, speed?
Well,
because Tabidi seems to have it.
No, speed he has, and what I like is that he has wheels. He flows in the ring. I mean, look, we were able to see two sparring matches back to back, and you know, he chose different styles in each. When he went versus the undefeated fighter who's going to remain nameless until after the fight, hopefully Keith Tapia wins and they'll allow me to put it up. I'm pretty sure they won't allow me to put it up if he loses, right? Who knows? But you know, he came forward. He made the fight. He was the aggressor, but still boxing. You know, kind of like Amir Khan, in and out. And then in the other sparring, who also will remain nameless until after the fight, he was kind of on the back foot. Not really being a counterpuncher, but it seemed like he was working on movement, working on being able to go more rounds. How many rounds is this fight? Because, you know, it's a Mayweather fight. This shit might be 8 rounds because they want to rob my boy.
It's a 10-rounder. They're both 10-rounders.
I hope by now they don't change it, man. Listen.
You know, listen,
no,
you've seen Keith Tapia more, Sean seen Tabidi more. I've seen them both less than y'all, but I think I've seen each guy more than both of y'all. You know what I'm saying? Like, Tapia more than Sean, I've seen Tabidi more than you. I really feel like a lot of things that y'all are saying about these guys can be said about the other guy. Like, it's crazy. Like, I think this is such an even fight. Like, the more I hear y'all talk about it, the more I am excited about watching what's going to happen.
I'm excited. I got another question for you, Sean. So you're saying he has levels. Have you witnessed that? Because I know you've been in that gym for 4 or 5, I don't know, since probably the beginning of the Mayweather gym. You've had to have watched this guy hit the bag, work with the pads, maybe spar someone. So
what's up, Ness? What were you asking? I
didn't
hear the question.
Oh, my God. Elbow off the top rope.
No, what was the question, though? I mean.
The question is, you said he has gears. Have you witnessed those gears in sparring in the gym? Because we haven't been privy to see that in his fights. He's been able to, like, walk him down. Have you seen him show you these gears, or are you assuming? Have you seen him in the sparring? Have you seen him in the gym?
Well, I mean, no one's tested the guy. When he's sparring, fishing in the Mayweather gym, because there's always good competition in the Mayweather gym, you're not going to not spar good competition. No, man, he's at the top level. So far, the eye test says he's championship level. So far, the eye test says there's no reason why he can't become WBC champion and the winner of this fight gets broken into those rankings. I mean, no one's had to force him into those levels, but through the first 12 fights where he's 12-0, 11 KOs, everything looks thumbs up. And I don't know, how many fighters that went on to become champions, guys like Lomachenko, exception, in their first 10 fights, did you really see them have to be tested. They were so good that they did what Tabidi's doing right now. They're just blowing guys out, you know, making it look like the other controller in the video game's not on. So
that's going.
What
Sean,
are you doing?
Let me ask you, Sean. Real quick. You are you're perfect. You and Fernando have done phenomenal, you know, throughout these years, and today especially. You guys both need to regularly drop in like that, and definitely give the listeners, your listeners, these tidbits, man, these little pieces of information that they're otherwise not privy to because they're hard at work on their eight to
exactly.
you know their nine to five.
Let's get. How legit is that Tabidi power? I mean, I know he's 12-0, 11 KOs, but where's the degree at, Sean?
The power, Mario, you said? I would say at cruiserweight, very legit. Knockout power. When you get up against the world-class fighters, guys aren't just going to get out of there with one shot. But in terms of the knockout power at cruiserweight, it's all real. But the question for Tabidi is, how many guys do we know have made big money in the cruiserweight division? Not even Holyfield before he moved up. So can he become a heavyweight is the question, and that's where he's going to run into problems because all the guys in the heavyweight division aren't just good. They're good and they're huge, like Tyson Fury, Deontay Wilder, and Anthony Joshua at 6'6". This kid's more of a normal-sized man. He's 6'2", 6'3", more closer to 6'2", 200 pounds. Cruiserweight, sky's the limit. The problem for Tabidi with power and everything is going to come in at heavyweight.
Mario, that's going to be the downfall right there. That kid is muscular, right? Then you got to mix that in with a dab of Mayweather influence. Then mix that in with some shoulder roll bullshit, right? And mix it in with all the TMT hats in the crowd in his hometown, telling them that he's the fucking man. When all he knows is Keith Tapia is nobody, but little does he know, Keith Tapia is about 196 to 193 during training camp, moving like a fucking cheetah, and we're going to see. We got ourselves a fight.
I'm so
excited. Yo, it's so insane to be able to soup yourself up. I made my own little pay-per-view with this fight. Listen, let me get to some callers. Sean, mute yourself, but don't go away so we can get some closing thoughts before we wrap it up. We're going to go to the closing argument to this Golovkin call or topic because, you know, obviously no one better than to close it then.
I know an amigo who will charge you zero and throw you a kilo. Woo! I bet in the week, bro, your pockets be stuffed like Chipotle burritos.
What's up, guys? AB here.
What up, baby?
So, all right, so first of all, Golovkin Lemieux did over $2 million in gate, okay? And did more ticket sales than Canelo Khan, right? Second of all right, I'm reading these reports from the pay-per-view numbers, okay? And multiple sources have the numbers at 460,000, okay? And that is coming from Yahoo Sports writer Kevin Eole, whose pay-per-view numbers tend to be the most accurate, have it at 460,000 pay-per-view buys. And a live attendance of 16,500, okay? Now, we all know Khan is a bigger star than Lemieux because Khan has headlined, okay, in the U.S. before. He's appeared many times, his fought in the U.S. Nobody even knows who the hell David Lemieux is, okay? That's fact, right? Second of all, Rick Glasser, you remember all the callers, right, quoting Rick Glasser, you know, Lemieux, Golovkin at 100K? Is saying that it really did 330K, okay? All of a sudden, you know, Rick Glasser, nobody's mentioning him, the same callers that were calling in, and everybody's now saying that the promoters
but
are
AB,
all on
give
it.
Give me credit,
right.
AB. Give me credit because I did.
Okay. No, I'm not talking about you, yeah. So, okay, number one, Golovkin is one of the biggest ticket sellers in all of boxing. That's a fact, okay? Canelo hasn't fought at junior middleweight for the past 3 years. That's a fact, okay? And what's up with all these callers? I don't understand boxing fans nowadays. Like, this is a unification fight. Why are people calling in trying to say that the fight should not happen? This shit just baffles me. It's like, you know, it's like people are saying Golovkin hasn't fought anybody and he wants to fight the number one guy out there from 160 below, right?
and people are saying he shouldn't fight this person. It's like Golovkin hasn't fought anybody. Golovkin's gonna fight somebody, right? And then all of a sudden, it's like, wait a minute, he shouldn't fight him. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, Golovkin needs to fight Danny Jacobs. Let's make the fight happen. Wait a minute, he shouldn't fight him now. Like, I don't understand. Like, it's a catch-22. Every time he tries to fight somebody, it's like, wait a minute, give him 3-4 more fights. Oh, wait a minute, he doesn't need him. All of a sudden, we boxing fans, right, are turning into businessmen. You know what I mean? Canelo can fight so-and-so and make so-and-so. No shit, he can make so-and-so. But is he going to make more? Because I'll tell you right now, 450,000 pay-per-view buys isn't saying a lot for a guy. For a guy that has 100 million Mexicans, a guy that has a whole country behind him, 100 million Mexicans, 460,000 pay-per-view buys isn't saying a lot, okay? And then Virgil Hunter actually is a piece of the puzzle to making this fight happen, okay? So by Virgil Hunter coming out and Amir Khan coming out and saying that, hey, you know what, you got to stop hiding behind the flag and make the fight happen, all it's doing is contributing to making the fight happen, and we should be applauding Virgil Hunter instead of saying, why is he saying that? I don't understand boxing fans nowadays. I'm being serious, because this is the biggest fight in boxing right now. The fight needs to happen right now, okay? And we have people calling in and trying to say that Canelo should not face him right now. We shouldn't make the fight happen right now. We got your co-host, James, calling in saying that Golovkin needs to drop all plans of unification and move up and face Badu Jack. Like, what the hell? Seriously? Like, that's got to be one of the most retarded, you know, statements by your panel in a long time. That, like,
hey,
he's got to drop all
Mike
plans of unification.
Exit on your outro. This, that, you should end it, not take it, not drag it. It sounds great. I'm with you. Except for the James part. But go ahead if you want
to
drag
it. The fight needs to happen, all right? If Canelo doesn't take this fight, it's going to tarnish his legacy. He's going to go down in history as the guy who ducked his unification fight. And I'm telling you, all the Hispanics and everybody is going to remember this. So if he wants to solidify his legacy, Canelo has to take this fight. He doesn't have any other choice, because fighting Amir Khan and fighting, blown up welterweights is not going to solidify his legacy after losing to Mayweather. He's got to take this fight.
What if people are like, hey, man, he's still too young, man. He should drag it out and then fight him. He's too young to fight him. You know, people are saying
that. Yeah, sure. He could face Golovkin when he's 40, but then he'll be remembered as the guy who didn't fight Golovkin in his prime. That's what it's gonna go down to.
Right now,
if he ducks and loses the belt, how is that gonna look like right now in front of the Mexican media, in front of all his fans? In history, how is he gonna look? Like, let's stop the whole business, and it's the biggest fight that he could take right now. You know, there's no other bigger fight for him right now. If they make this fight right now in Cowboy Stadium, it's gonna do 100,000. There's gonna be 100,000 seats in Texas for this fight.
And if
that's a bold statement. 100,000 is a lot, AB. But listen, if you've been listening to me at all, AB, you know how I feel about this fight. You know that I think it's going to happen. I think it should happen. But that being said, I feel like you're talking about it from one side, to say that if he ducks, like, look what will happen. But what will happen if he loses too? You know, that then a lot of the mystique starts to disappear, because right now Canelo has the ability to say, well, I beat Lara, I beat Trout, so I'm not just a cash cow. I'm not just the guy that the Mexicans are behind. I'm also really talented. But if he steps up and loses to Golovkin, that mystique disappears. You know what I'm saying? So it's a very tricky position for him. But my point is, I think he dug himself into a hole. By talking the talk that he's talked, it puts him in a position where, now backing down, you're right, he does lose that machismo that you get from the Hispanic fans and from the Mexican fans. So I think that's where he's messed up. It's not, they're not on really on this collision course, because all this call for a fight, like, this is stemming back from Sergio Martinez's title reign. We're desperate to see Golovkin get this title shot because we've been wanting it for so long, but Canelo really just got the belt.
Yeah, but that's just a cheap excuse. Listen, let's get to our last caller here. 626, what's going on?
Hey, I feel, man, at this point, there's no need for panicking, you know? Like he just said, this guy, hey, he just got the belt. Hey, I want to see Golovkin fight at least one name, and that name is Jacobs. Then after that Jacob fight, after he knocks him out, or depends what happens in the fight, then we could see the Canelo fight. Hey, let's remember, Canelo already fought Mayweather. Canelo already fought Cotto. You know what I mean? Now, he fought Lara, and he looked bad. He fought Mayweather, and he looked bad. Now he took another challenge versus the guy that's super fast. Yes, of course, we all know that he had a chin, but what would have happened if he would have lost? You know what I mean? There's no need for panicking. Canelo used to spar. Canelo used to hire Triple G.
The fight not going
to
happen?
Not happening, that's what he's saying.
No, the fight, I feel the fight is going to happen. These guys know each other.
Because of the drag of the fight. The dragging.
No, because
like,
what happened, we're all panicking because
making pay for other
we're all
fights
panicking.
The fight.
No, yeah, that's we all, I understand that. We're all panicking because of what happened with Mayweather and Pacquiao. I don't think it's going to happen. These guys used to spar with each other, bro. This guy used to hire Triple G to train with him for his previous fights. So these guys know each other. They used to spar with each other. I don't think Canelo's ducking it. I don't think it's just – I just feel that one or two more fights, I feel is going to happen. I don't think Canelo it's ducking anybody. I just feel that the timing right now, he just got the belt last fight.
But what
you know, let me make some money.
Want to see before it happens? Like what has to be proven? I don't.
He said Jacobs. He said Jacobs.
Yeah, but why? Why? People aren't asking for that. People aren't asking for Stevenson and Canelo. You know, the most people are asking for myself is Lemieux and Canelo. That's it. The most.
Yeah,
there's no one else.
But Golovkin would
again,
have to fight
again,
too.
You have to live in boxing's reality. And this reality is you never get what you want. You never get what you want.
Right.
Sean, is there a sell by date on this Canelo Golovkin fight?
Yeah, Ness. My feeling on Canelo and Triple G is that the fight has an expiration date a little bit. I think the fight needs to happen by May of next year, but I think the fight will happen in May of next year. That's why I say that. In the meantime, I think what would be perfect is if, and I asked Oscar De La Hoya this after Canelo knocked out Khan, is can we get a collision course card like Bernard and Oscar did, where both guys fight at 160, you know, Golovkin against whoever, another no-hoper, and Canelo against Lemieux on the main event. Put them both in Vegas. It makes everybody happy. Golden Boy gets to make a little money. Canelo gets to make a little money. Triple G gets to make a little money. Canelo gets that one fight in at 160 in the meantime, and everybody's guaranteed that the fight happens Cinco de Mayo 2017. Now, if it happens is another thing. I hope it does, but, you know, Canelo's getting a lot of flack for not taking this fight right now, but as long as he takes it in May or even at the latest in September of 2017, it's all noise. You know, we all want it to happen ASAP. I would love it for it to happen ASAP, but as long as we get the guys both in their primes, and I don't think anyone thinks Golovkin's going to get old in the next year, it's all noise, man, as long as we get the fight in their prime, and I think we will.
Yeah, absolutely. Well said, Sean. And, you know, my cousin actually, we were at Taco Bell a couple days ago, and he was like, oh, I saw Sean's interview where he was like, yo, I'm going to ask him. And he asked Oscar about putting them both on the same card. And see, Ness's whole point is, you know, mutual opponents, right? And your point is putting two guys on the card. These are tried and true ways of promoting
right.
the fight. There is nothing wrong with going through these steps to ensure that you get the maximum amount of exposure for this fight. So I agree with you 100%. It was an awesome interview. My cousin enjoyed it for whatever that's worth, and Ness's points are great too.
Yeah, thanks, Mario. Yeah, and, you know, it, like you said, it's a tried-and-true method. It's always worked. Leonard and Hearns took a year to let it marinate before they fought each other.
really the only super fight that was held on too long for was Mayweather and Pacquiao. And I just don't think we're going to have that problem here.
Speaking of Lennon and Hearns, Mario, shots fired. AB says you're wrong with your history because history has shown people who get KO'd take fights don't lose fan bases. Chavez Sr. and Duran.
No, no, no. I'm not saying that he loses fan. I mean, it's a risk to him. Canelo doesn't want to lose. I'm not talking about, you know, listen, if he loses to Canelo, I mean, Golovkin, in my opinion, it's similar to him losing to Mayweather. Like, there's no problems with that. But from his standpoint, from where he's coming from, Canelo doesn't want to lose. He wants to maximize his ability to win that fight. It would be a cheap shot for him to wait till Golovkin's 40. You're absolutely right, AB. But at the same time, they're not going to exit their primes by May of next year.
Well, and if you guys don't mind, I want to add, it's all about how you fight, win or lose. You know, speaking of Duran, the way Leonard lost their first fight, he got more respect in losing that his first loss than he did it up to that point, and he win. The way Duran lost in the second fight with the infamous Nov Mas took more credibility away from Duran than any fight before. So I think regardless if Canelo loses to Golovkin, if he shows nuts, as my friend told me, if he shows nuts and it's a fight of the year kind of fight, not only do I think he'll still have respect, he'll probably be in line for a second fight with Golovkin. I mean, we could be talking about two or three fights with these guys.
Geico presents sharing versus oversharing. Yesterday, Cliff Sora shared a top 10 list of hot fusion restaurants, a vegan gluten-free mashup recipe, and a podcast featuring organic food trends. Oh, TMI, too much internet information. That's oversharing. Cliff, Geico has something worth sharing with your friends. Like how on geico.com you could save hundreds on your car insurance, update your policy, and report a claim. Gluten-free info that's easy to swallow. Mm. Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
Listen, and people think...
Very good point.
People think it's just me or it's just Mario, you know? Even now, casuals getting stopped for pictures, right? But we got a whole fleet of knowledgeable dudes. Sean, you've done a great job, man. We want to see more of you.
Yes, I really like Sean's call, man. He gave one side, Ness, you gave the other side. That was a very informative. This was like a on-air 24-7.
Yo,
dope.
You know what it is, though? It's time to make those official picks. So you're sticking with TMT because you said you're a Mayweather fan.
Who, me?
Yeah. Yes.
No, I switched sides. I'm now Keith Tapia.
Why? Why?
I don't believe that shoulder roll works for anybody.
Puerto Rico.
It works for, like, Pretty Boy Floyd, who then evolved to Money Mayweather. I got to see. I don't know him. I'm taking a blind
Yo,
pick.
But basically you saying Tapia. I did a better job arguing my fighter.
Yeah, that's the purpose, right? We're like the old days. Muhammad Ali, George Foreman on the radio, watch the fight that way or
okay.
Listen to the fight.
Okay, listen.
So I picked Keith Tapia.
No, I just hope
Sean.
I'm right. I just hope I'm – oh, you're rolling with Sean, are you?
I'm rolling with Sean. Andrew Tabidi, I think he's going to win it. I was a little less confident when I made the pick earlier, and after hearing Sean eloquently discuss – this man's, you know, abilities, I am a little more confident.
All right. Well, Sean is officially Tabidi, right, Sean?
Yes, sir.
And, Sean,
yes,
you have absolutely no way for listeners to get a hold of you because you do not believe in social media unless you guys want to find him on Xbox or something.
Sean, that is dope.
Or you could just watch his videos and comment on him.
Hit me up on
Sean.
Facebook, too,
Fight Fan. Yeah, that's Sean. Oh, yeah. For people that don't know, Sean Zatel is the guy that the video always says Sean Zatel, but with the long hair, you know, Shaggy, looking like Shaggy from
Shaggy.
Scooby-Doo.
He's our only Vegas guy.
Yo, this is the most famous Vegas guy, too. He's been on, like, 24. How many 24/7s have you been on now, Sean?
It was combining the 24/7 with the Showtime All Access about four times. And then the best one was Mayweather Guerrero. I was the intro in slow-mo because they had me punching with Ruben Guerrero. So
I remember that.
I don't remember that. I'm going to go back and watch.
Yeah, those little CBD memories, man. You know, we make a milestone here. Listen, Sean, I want to thank you again. And we got to absolutely get you on on this panel once we get this video situated again. But thank you and continue the good work. Tomorrow, smash it out there. When Keith Tapia wins, you let Flex you say, Flex, how you doing? I'm Sean from the Boxing Voice. Ness sent me. He was just so, yeah, Ness, the tall Dominican. Yep, mm-hmm. Boom, that's it. They're going to, well, after that, they might even give you food.
Okay, cool.
And water.
All right, Sean, well, take it easy. Have a good night. All right, ladies and gentlemen, it is that time, unfortunately. Damn, I've been wanting to do this for so, man, I'm really mad at YouTube. They played us. Some idiots talking about Ness thinks he's going to beat YouTube. No, I don't think I'm going to beat YouTube. They suspended us. There's nothing we can do. We just got to wait it out or contest it. I don't know. I'm hoping Mario writes a letter that, you know, is dipped in gold, and when we follow it, it's the yellow brick road to the Wizard of Oz of YouTube, who allows us to get our magic powers back.
After that.
You know? Because it's unfortunate, man. I mean, if they wanted to take the video down, they could have did that. But damn, taking the ability to reach you guys.
Yo, they saw us coming. You know what I mean? Listen, the numbers are growing, and they were like, damn, these dudes are a threat. We got to wipe them out of the existence.
Too late.
But we got friends. We got friends at YouTube. Don't even think that we don't, okay? Mm. We got friends at YouTube, just like we got friends at Blog Talk.
Mm.
They love us. They know us.
Mm.
We'll be back.
He ain't lying. So listen, I want to get this Keith Thurman and this Luis Ortiz thing wrapped up. So swing that. Matter of fact, Casual.
What's up?
Give them something nice as I go look in my magic box to see what glove I'm going to give away.
Well, you know, Vargas prefers to have the proposed fight with Brook in Las Vegas, his hometown. Initially, he said he would not go to Brooktown, and he wants Brook to come to the United States. If he came out here once and fight, who was that, Sean Porter? Yeah, he said if he would come out here to fight Sean Porter, he shouldn't have a problem to come out here. So I'm really interested in this fight. I just watched the Saddam Ali highlights.
All right, Casual, I'm back. I'm back.
Bomb Squad!
Thank you.
Bomb Squad, is that going to be on the air or what? Because I'm hearing rumors about that.
Yes.
Not being televised.
Of course, man. People who think that fight won't be aired by Showtime is weird. Like, why would they sign Joshua?
It's part of the build-up, right?
Yeah, why would they sign Joshua and not invest in their American heavyweight? Whatever. So what I'm holding right here, which you can't see because YouTube shut us down, is a Danny Swift Garcia. Whoa. And even though on this show, for whatever reason, people act like they hate him, he's super popular if you look at analytics. And
those
even
are
on
hardcore fans.
And even on this show, he's super popular. So that being said, I need a Keith one time, Thurman and Lewis, King Kong, Ortiz, contributor, to make sure that we get to Florida. So whoever helps me the most is going to get this Danny Garcia autograph signed glove. And I'm going to throw in a bonus. To the people that don't win, I'll let your names go in the runnings for a Steve Cunningham signed autograph glove. And that
very
is
nice.
CBD.
Very nice.
You know how you should do it?
Hooking it up.
It's real easy. It's real easy now.
What?
Everybody should just give a dollar, you know?
Man, I've said that all my life. Like,
you could give a dollar.
If every listener gave $1, you'd never hear us complain. We would even
cost more than a dollar.
Listen, let me tell you something. YouTube wouldn't even be a problem because we would, you know, be able to have our own studio and just, like, do the show. Hey, hi, Mom. Who's that? Is that your real mom?
Yeah.
We never see Mario's real mom. And unfortunately for you guys, it's the first time that we're not live, so you don't get to see her either.
You have a fake mom, Mario?
Nah.
She's like, you got a real mom.
They don't live in Corpus, so, you know, it's rare. It's rare that they're here. So.
Yeah, you know.
Congratulations.
Mario's a young bachelor with a whole home all to himself. So listen, guys, if you're not going to support and help me get to Florida to get the insane coverage that I've been bringing you,
50 cents,
you know, that casual fan lens, you know, that camera that he uses is not cheap. So listen, if you're not going to contribute to get us there, right, then don't forget to use the Loot Crate. At the very least, the Amazon link, if you're going to do some shopping, Father's Day is coming, Mother's Day just passed. Remember, you can always order that 1 month free Showtime using that Amazon link. Plus, you get that Prime. You get free streaming, too, which I use. And you can do it on your
TV. Something else easier they can do.
What is that?
Just tell your friend, man, to log on, to tune in, to download the app. They want boxing information. They got the hardcore Mario. They got the hardcore Ness. Ness is boxing, sparring with professional fighters. And then they got the casual fan that they can probably relate with, you know, who watches the fights and makes mistakes and not afraid to do it, not afraid of embarrassment. So let's go.
Casual, why they try to make you feel like casual fans suck? I'm a casual fan. They say it all the time. I don't know if you see it in the comments.
I see it all the time.
Yeah.
The thing that pisses me off is that I see
it
all
the time. But
you know
what? Let me tell you what you have to come to grips with. This is the key.
Oh, I'm in
They
grips.
Only call you a casual because you like to dream. You're okay with dreaming. Like, you want the big fight. Or the Con Canelo, you were okay with that because it sounded sexy, right?
It was a marquee fight.
Yeah, you know what I mean? You like to dream, so that you're a casual. Con ain't got no chin, casual. Con ain't got no chest. A stupid fight, and you're stupid. No,
right.
No, they're
right.
just
so
haters, man. They don't want to be happy.
Real quick, right?
Well, I'll tell you what. Listen, if you can find, I mean, listen, James is one of the smartest.
This is CBB Overdrive.
People that break down fights I've ever heard. He's made mistakes just like I've made mistakes. There's nobody that's ever been on this panel that hasn't made a mistake. Like, that's just real talk.
That's fine, but you guys call mistakes like your prediction not being right. My thing is this.
I'll fuck up when Tyson fought Lewis or, like, I'll mess that shit up all the time.
But
I'm terrible
like
with games.
You were 14 years old when that fight happened, right?
True, yeah.
So my thing is this, right? You know, every sport, you know, they stick with their team, like football and basketball.
We're bringing Canadian Jose on. He stuck with us. This is Overdrive. If anyone was still listening past that intro, they deserve to be on. Because once you hear that intro, most people are like, oh, damn, they're playing the outro. It's time to go. I'm out. And they start dipping off. But Jose's over there with the kids trying to rock them to sleep, still listening, right? Oh, Jose.
Yo, man, I'm here, man. What's going on? Yo, I agree with casual, man. That's the beauty of not being a hardcore bitter fuck, man. We can actually enjoy the sport. We love it just as much as everyone else, but we're not bitter by it, you know? So good for us, casual. Let's keep it real, bro.
And that's exactly what I was saying about the floor seats, right? Jose is considered Deke a casual fan, right? So it's like, but he flies to fucking Vegas for Canelo while I'm considered a hardcore and I'm right here in my house in Jersey.
And complaining about the price of the fight.
Exactly.
And talking about streaming.
Exactly.
So you're stealing from the sport you love and call yourself hardcore fans.
The hardcores are worse than you, casual.
Ness, we got Ness driving down to Florida, and you don't want to give him $1.
$1.
Yes! To fight your fighter. And quit on YouTube.
Yo, and quit on YouTube.
Because the shit hurts, bro.
It did. And a trip to Florida is just, you know, I'm letting you know, it's 1,300 miles. So fuck it, man. Just give me $1 a mile.
$1 a mile.
Listen, real quick, I do want to say that there is another good cruiserweight fight on that Showtime card. Michael Hunter, Isaiah Thomas. I feel like that's another 60-40 on either side. I'm going to go with Hunter, even though I think Isaiah Thomas can win this fight. But I'm going to go with Michael Hunter.
Hunter's the undefeated Olympian, right?
Yeah. And then Dusty Hernandez, Harrison,
Mike Dallas
Jr.
I'm going with
Dusty. I like that fight.
Yeah, but come on. Dallas has been out of the ring for like forever, and his two comeback fights have been in Mexico. He's probably not even – he probably couldn't even get cleared. I don't even know. Like, who goes to Mexico if you're black? Like, that's a little shaky right
Yo,
there.
But Creed. They're fighting on BET.
Ah,
you
said Creed. Yeah, Creed. Casual, you see?
But they're fighting on BET. I'm going to watch it because it's the only fight that's going to be – oh, actually, no, there's a B in sports, too, I think. Maybe. No.
Yo, this Overdrive is official.
Hey, so, I'm going to go with Dusty.
That's dope.
Yeah,
I want to say one thing.
I'm going with
real
Dusty,
quick,
too.
Mario.
I got a hot interview I'm putting out with Dusty in like T4, 26 seconds. It's dope. Like, really,
Mario,
really dope.
Real quick, on overtime, right? Mm-hmm. Boxing. All right, so basketball and football. The Knicks suck.
That's the point you were making.
The Knicks, I mean, I don't know if they suck. But, you know, I hear hardcore basketball fans, they choose the Brooklyn Nets or whoever they would, Magic, the Warriors. They choose and they stick. The Knicks, the fans that belong to the Knicks are there. They believe that the Knicks are going to win against Miami when they had LeBron's. And I might be spitting empty thoughts. But, LeBron was on Miami. Now we got Steph Curry. I don't know who this guy is. I never watch it, but I hear his name the most. In boxing, people, they don't dream, man. Hardcores, they don't dream. And that's why Danny Garcia beat Khan. That's why Lennox Lewis beat Mike Tyson. That's why whoever else was an underdog won and the Casual Fan won. And they fill in that gap. So, you'll be real, Hardcores. Georgie's right. He wants to see fights immediately. It don't happen that way because they got to pay the bills and they want to build the fighter. So, I just wanted to say that, man. Other sports have committed fans to a person. Boxing, they switch sides. And we're blinded by the marketing. We're blinded by the brand. You know, you see the TMT, you're like, oh, I'm going for him. He's with TMT.
No, you see the TMT and you go for him.
Yeah, I do. I make that mistake. But I'm not.
My
I'm going for
Floyd.
You know, but
my
you
name
know,
is
so
there's something associated with that logo and you
there
see
is.
It. You know what I mean? So you're not wrong.
Yeah, you got my dude, Jack.
Oh, you see it.
You know?
Yeah,
so, yeah.
You're not wrong.
Yo,
dope
so
show.
You know what's funny? You know what's funny that Sean didn't say that a guy like, you know, I don't know. It's funny that he didn't say that this guy, you know, like he didn't get to see him change gears in the gym. Like, so Jay Leon Love, like none of those other guys in there, like Badu Jack, none of them push Tabidi just because he's a cruiserweight. So that Dusty Harrison interview is out. It's something new. This whole style I did. Casual might be proud of me. I mean, not really, because it's definitely not your level.
Yo,
it's not your level.
Proud. This is like a dream to me. I'm in my living room. I've said things that I want to say on my own without nobody holding me back, and I got in trouble, and I got backlash about it in comments. I got backlashes from Nesta texting me like, yo, you can't be saying that. These are hardcores. They know more than you. And I'm here, man. I'm always in the right place. And I'm the fan behind the stanchions that made it by accident. So I will get better. And, you know, the boxing voice is the truth. I used to follow other reporters, let's call them, and other news feeds. But this is the best news feed alive, on the air, live before the suspension because it got too big. And everybody that is giving out news, it's just like piggyback news. This is like official news. And I'm not saying that because I'm here. Had I known about this show beforehand, I probably would not have been on it. So this is all by accident. And thank you, Nesta. You are the man. You travel, you fighting fighters. Just seeing you fighting or sparring, let's call it, just put a smile on my face. Like I watched it more than once. Tonight, and I'm being on the show. So applaud. Thank you, everybody who hates and those who appreciate. Love you too.
Casual gets so emotional, right, Mario? He's like, yo, he's like, yo, fuck y'all if y'all hate me, but yo, don't hate me, man. If you just get to know me, if
you can
just,
hate me,
if you
I'm just
get
passionate
to know me,
about
yo.
It on another level where you guys are passionate about it as a hardcore. Not
nah, yo, I understand,
I just think,
man.
I just think that you. I think, Enrique, I think you have a misconception that they hate, like, everybody hates me and loves me. Listen, go to the comments.
Let
me make a quick announcement.
Love me. I'm the smartest on the panel. I'm the dumbest on the panel. Like,
you come off like you graduated from boxing college.
Yo, let me. Yeah.
I dropped out of boxing college.
Let me make.
You re-enrolled, so.
Let me make a quick announcement because somebody told me the best. His name was Wood the God, right? Let me get to his intro. Let me get his intro because I don't know why he ain't calling, Wood.
It's Baltimore, gentlemen. The gods will not save you.
Wood told me the best. He said, Ness, they hate you, but once you be gone, they be missing you, right?
Yep.
That being said, May 31st, mark it in your calendars. I am out, daddy-o. The kid is gone.
Ooh, I get
the bird is flying. But I'm telling you this, because YouTube suspended our video, that makes things super easy. And maybe if it's a major fight when I'm chilling and not supposed to be working, then we just might do a international show.
Or maybe your boy takes over hosting duties like he's done in the past.
Even though my boy said he was going to meet me out there, but you know how that goes.
Every day it's like, yo, I thought we were going to take a break.
Yo, we don't take breaks over here, man.
I missed the
365 days a year, and on average, we give them at least 105 shows on average. You know? And this year, we've taken on demand, so Yo, she's talking about on demand. I'm putting Mario on blast. MK, it's all Mario's fault. Whenever he says he's ready, I'm ready.
I'm ready.
I've done massive
search. I know
you're
not putting me on blast.
Yo, I've interviewed everybody. I'm ready to go.
I'm ready. Yo, I texted you. I was ready.
All right.
Too bad
we need
can't
to
do a roll call.
Yo, actually, we can't even do it in the next 2 days or so because James is actually gone for a while. He said he's gonna be missing for the next 2 shows. So that's how long his vacation is. It's his anniversary, so tweet James something nice, and if you ain't got nothing nice to say, don't fucking say it at all. That being said, we're out. Yo, I got to go, man. I'm hungry as hell.
Peace.
Peace.
Bye-bye.
Yo.
T-Mobile's unlimited plan costs $95 per month for a smaller network, plus monthly taxes and fees. It's enough to wreck your day. Cricket's unlimited plan gives you a bigger network for $25 less per month with monthly taxes and fees included. Cricket Wireless, something to smile about.
Download speeds max of 8 megabits per second LTE and 4 megabits per second 4G. Price comparison based on one smartphone line with unlimited plan. Mobile hotspot not available. Activation, other fees, and restrictions apply. Coverage not available everywhere. Terms, features, and restrictions subject to change. See store for details.